turnip soup.
Mm-hmm. Chicken and turnip.
Lovely.
High protein, low carbs. Great weight management. Eat as much as you want.
Or I may start. Bring me some. Or I'll make it. Give me the recipe.
I'm sick of sending that thing out, too.
Oh, people asking for it.
It's not really that big of a deal.
It's turnips. It's something I can write down.
You know what? I looked at the recipe today. Some guy sent me an email trying to knock off some weight. And I looked at it. It's a long, drawn-out thing, but it really shouldn't be. I mean, he talks about sauteing this and doing this and then all these different... Just throw turnips and cubed low-fat chicken breast in there and whatever else you want. You know, vegetables, seasonings. Cook, can't you?
Yeah.
Just dump seasonings in there until it tastes like crap. And when you get to that point, don't add that again.
Excuse me. Well, I just don't know how much of each thing you put in here. Like onions, cilantro,
mm-hmm.
Chili powder.
Yep. Jalapenos.
Jalapenos.
I make it as hot as I can get it. Habaneros.
I remember when you made it for me. It was very good. Very spicy, but good. I could eat that.
And you use the turnips because if you use potatoes, too many carbs. The turnips take on potato consistency. That's why I use it.
So she just get turnips, fill up the thing, just fill it up. About equal chicken, equal turnips.
I don't know.
Well, that's why I ask. I don't know percentages.
Here, yeah, we'll start again.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
Ah! Quit it! Ah! Ah! Ah!
All right. Ah! It's twice.
Sorry.
2 minutes. Eyes are watering.
Hey.
Yeah, John?
I have a question here. I'm about to go on a diet similar to yours. I overheard you say low-carb, high-protein.
And you know what? Let me point out something that John just did that was perfect. As soon as I started talking, mm-hmm. he got straight to the point.
Right.
Didn't jack around. Wasn't a great big long pause. He was right in there going. Go get him, John.
Hey, Russ. Love your show.
All right. Now, 10 seconds of dead air. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
What I'm worried about is getting a kidney stone. Have you ever gotten one because of this high-protein thing? I know you lose a lot of weight on the carb thing, and I'm just scared poopless to get, you know, a kidney stone doing this. I saw it lay my father-in-law up for a couple of weeks, and I am not going down that road.
Why would you get a kidney stone from low carbs?
I heard that just from high-protein diets, if you have, like, way too much protein.
Hang on. Let's get McNeil in here. He's been on this diet for a couple of years. Hold on. Hey, Brainiac. Is Saggy back there with you?
No, but I will find him for you.
Yes, please find him and bring him in here. Problem is, McNeil's lost too much weight.
Mm-hmm. Well, what does he weigh for his height? What is he, 5'10"?
Doesn't make any difference. Looks like a Sharpei. He does. I think any extreme is too much. I don't care what the diet is.
I still need to lose about 15. Be where I want to be.
You want to be at 280?
You're hilarious.
Where are you at now?
282, or 182.
You want to get down to what?
I figured about 168, 67. Should be about right.
Back up. Turn around. Hold on. I didn't see your ass. Put your pants down.
No! This is great. Worked out again last night.
Well, then you're done.
I'm not done, by any means. Embarrassing when you fall off that stupid round ball. She has me doing crunches on one of those round balls.
Oh, I thought you were doing the bear act
again. Oh, no. No, I quit that.
Why are you doing crunches on a ball?
It really works your center core better than just doing it on a bench because you're also having to balance at the same time you're having to do the crunches.
Why can't you just use weights?
You could use weights if you want to add more weight to it. I'm doing crunches without weights right now.
Why?
Trying to get my abs tight. So
use weight.
Weight in what way? Hold on in your chest? There's a million ways to do crunches.
Yeah.
That's just one.
Put weight on your chest.
I'm doing okay without it right now. It's hurting enough.
Don't get on the ball. That's stupid.
It's not stupid. It's balance. In fact, if you could do all your weightlifting.
Well, when Barnum comes into town, you'll be ready.
It works more muscles. It works, makes your core stronger, as opposed to a bench, which is stable.
Well, then I would certainly do it that way.
She's a big believer in free weights.
Good. I don't like free weights. That's how you get hurt.
No.
It is, too. No, if the weight ain't hooked up to something and you let it go,
Yeah.
I like weights with cables, pulleys, handles. This free weight crap.
She's a big believer in that because it works on balance as well as muscle.
I would say you would probably want to work with non-free weights to begin with, and when you build up your strength, then you go to free weights.
I work with small ones. I don't work with 50, 60 pounds. I'm working with 12 and a half.
Don't we sound like pussies?
Yeah.
I ain't using enough. What's the matter with you? I ain't benching 60 pounds.
It's so embarrassing because I'm standing next to guys that are curling 70 in each hand, and I got 7.5.
They got barbells over at Academy that are 75 pounds apiece.
Oh, I know. The barbell I work out with. The barbell.
No, I don't mean the barbell. I mean a dumbbell.
Oh.
Where you do curls.
Oh, yeah.
With one arm.
I saw those guys.
75 pounds.
I know.
How the hell do you do that?
I see these guys doing that. The barbell I work out with, the bar, but without any weight on it, is 45 pounds.
Which is plenty.
I'm taking a dookie, and they page me. What's the deal?
I'm trying to erase the image. Can you get kidney stones from this low-carb diet?
No.
Where did this, what did you hear, John?
Well, my father-in-law, he went on the Atkins diet because my mother-in-law lost like 40 pounds, like, quickie fast.
Right.
And he went on it, but I don't know if he followed the rules or whatever. I just know he ate a lot of meat. He lost a lot of weight. But 7 days later, he's up in the doctor's office with a kidney stone.
Had him already.
Yeah, he's right. You don't get a kidney stone in a week.
You don't get a kidney stone in a week. Doesn't happen.
So do you just follow the diet?
What diet are you on now, Bob?
I'm kind of on a modified Atkins. It's really the Sugar Busters diet.
Well, what is that?
Well, it's basically, it's sort of like Atkins, it says, except that it says that all carbohydrates are not created equally. In other words, there are carbohydrates that break down quickly in your bloodstream, and there are others that don't. Naturally occurring carbohydrates like fructose and things like that don't break down as fast as manufactured carbohydrates like white bread and refined sugar and refined flour.
All right, so you're talking like the difference between fruit and processed food.
Yes.
All right.
But to start out with, you do have to go on a very strict diet to get your body into what's called ketosis.
Oh, that is the stupidest thing. I was going through that. I'm in the bathroom, and I finally stopped. I went, I'm whizzing on strips.
Mm-hmm. Yep. But that tells your body to start burning fat instead of burning carbohydrate. And that's the key to the whole thing. There are several elements a lot of people leave out, though. Like, you have to exercise.
Mm-hmm.
People don't want to do that. But Dr. Atkins says you must exercise 3 days
same
a week.
Same guy had a heart attack. Minutes. Heart attack. Excuse me.
Who had a heart attack?
Atkins.
Is he alive?
You don't get credit for suffering through a heart attack.
Is he very healthy? Yes, he is. You know, we all know heart attacks are a lot more to do with what your parents were than...
Yeah, it certainly has nothing to do about eating meat for 40 years.
No, of course.
What, how long have you
been on... You eat fish and chicken.
The Atkins diet said any type of meat.
No, and he also says don't overeat. That's the other thing a lot of people say, well, you can just eat all you want.
I think the book that you gave me said eat as much as you want.
No.
Of the meat.
No, it doesn't say that. It doesn't say, it says don't overeat.
I never saw that.
It's in there.
Okay.
Center.
How long have you been on the this low-carb, high-protein diet?
Just a little over 2 years. March, 2 years ago.
What did you weigh when you started?
220.
You really?
Yeah, I went back to the doctor a couple weeks ago for something, and I said, yeah, I think I started at 217. He looked at my records and said, no, you started at 220.
What are you now?
165.
Are you done?
Yeah, but you know what? It's really weird. I'm at the top of the... preferred weight scale for my body. 5'8" supposed to be 145 to 165.
You can't do that.
I don't think you can. If I was 145 pounds, I would be dead.
You already look sickly quick.
Thank you.
Have some taters.
I will. Red potatoes are actually better. They're okay.
Red potato?
Mm-hmm. They don't break down as fast as white potatoes.
I can't keep track of all this stuff.
It's real easy.
That's not easy.
Why don't you just do the thing you do?
What?
The turnips.
Oh, I don't know.
Turnips are great.
I tried the soup.
No carbs at all.
Yeah. I love carbs.
Wonderful. No, very little.
You got any questions, John, before Bob keels over?
No. Well, hey, and I know we're not girlfriends or anything, but if I email you, can you send me some recipe ideas?
Who, me?
Talking to me.
No. I don't know. I think I trust Russ more. He looks in better shape than you, Bob.
Look, thank you. You don't know what Bob looks like. Yeah, send it to me, and I'll send you the thing.
Thank you, Bob.
All right. Have you tried the chicken turnip soup?
No, I heard that, though. I thought that sounded great.
It is.
Yeah.
Because turnips don't taste like turnips when they
cook. No, they don't. They take absorb whatever you cook them in, basically.
Yeah.
So they taste like chicken.
It's perfect. Sometimes that's all I have all weekend.
We know. We can smell.
Good. That's the only upside to it is you get to fart a lot.
Yeah, that's... Well, actually, I do think you have a little more gas on this diet than I've had before.
You also had back problems before, which
have
gone away.
You had back problems, Bob?
You did.
Well, that was weight.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of things that I had problems with, I had sleep apnea. To some extent, that's gone. Because that's a weight-related deal, really is.
I wonder if that's Dan's problem. Dan Lewis? Because he's never gotten down to his...
No, that is
his appropriate weight.
I think it is.
There aren't any people with sleep apnea that don't have an overweight problem.
Well, really, he's got to sleep with that...
machine.
Yeah, the machine slapped to his head.
Yeah.
I know, he had it when I went to Mexico or Cancun. And he's on the other side of the room, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and it scared the hell out of me. Because you see this alien thing on his head with the tubes coming out.
Poor Laura.
Looks like the mask's in the cockpit for the pilots, yeah. You know.
I farted in this tube.
He had it coming. All right, well, thank you, Bob.
You're welcome.
All right. Sure. Bob McNeil.
Recipe page on your website. Just occasionally.
That's too queer.
It's
it
not.
Really is. It makes me feel queer just talking about
all
it
right.
Now.
Everybody eats, and look, guys are interested.
Guys don't cook. Most guys don't. The only all reason right. I cook is because there's nobody around to cook for me. Plus, I wouldn't trust them anyway.
That's true.
Look at Eddie. He don't cook.
Mm-mm. He's got a wife. She does it.
Did you cook when you weren't married?
A little bit. My kid, my oldest son, cooks a lot.
Yeah. All right. Query time's over. Okay. So everybody knows. If you want the recipe, email it. Email me. I don't want to hear about this again. I feel like that guy, that bald-headed guy with a really well-cut beard on the Fag Channel. Whatever his name is. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about?
I don't know what you're talking about, but I don't.
Thank you.
All right. Well, I'll just experiment. I won't even ask you.
I'll send it to you. It's not any big deal. I don't follow the recipe. I took the basics and just went from there. Hi, Jason.
Hey, Russ, what's going on?
Yeah.
Listen, I was listening to everybody calling in wanting to know exactly what to do, what do you eat, blah, blah, blah.
Mm.
Just get your ass out in the street and run a couple miles every day. Stop eating quarter pounders and stuff like that and man-made carbs, and you'll lose weight. Lay off the cold beer.
It makes common sense. I mean, it really does. You go out, and it's like, all right, if you're... And I even said before, you don't. When you go on a diet, you don't have to get on one of those weird, freaky diets to where you totally adjust your life. Take what you're used to, and then just gradually change it. Now, you're not going to lose a bunch of weight all at once, but if you lose a pound a month, at least you didn't gain a pound that month.
Well, I went from 242 to 165 in a year. I stopped eating the crap at the fast food restaurant, mm-hmm. put the beer away for a couple months, and started eating chicken instead of fatty meat and stuff like that, and ran every morning.
Yeah.
That'll take care of it.
All right. Well, thank you.
All right.
I hope he wasn't going to say he loved me. That's what I've been doing since I was 23. Gained a bunch of weight. Saw that I got fat. Took it off. In fact, you were there. You were the one that helped me get on the diet.
You kept it off.
That's not to say I don't miss Snicker bars. Or regular Dr. Pepper.
I don't
or going by Griff's and getting six hamburgers and two great big orders of fries.
God, I love the fries.
Jack in the Box tacos.
I love those.
That'd be my last meal.
And Corona Light.
It's my last meal.
Oh, Corona's okay. Lime.
But I certainly can't have the carbs.
Lord. Would you eat just till you're sick?
Oh, yes. It's my last meal. If you know, either I had cancer and I was dying or I was on death row, bring it on. However much they'll give you on death row, bring it on. If you got to take it out of my beer money, that's fine. Just bring me the tacos.
Yeah.
When they're hooking the needle up to me, I'm going to be bowling Jack in the Box fumes. There's no reason I should be the only one suffering on the table.
Yeah.
Ever wonder how many people would show up at your funeral?
I thought about that. I thought about that recently when I went to... Lance Pope's funeral, the guy that owns Thrillvania, or did, excuse
me. Verdun Manor?
Yeah, Verdun Manor. I went to his funeral and...
How many people show up?
Tons.
Really?
Tons of people. Church was completely full.
I always wish I could get away with faking my own death just to see how many would show up. Oh, everybody thought about that.
Then everybody'd be pissed when you popped up and went, kidding.
They'd be happy.
No, they wouldn't.
Yes, they would.
Everybody, you made everybody cry for 2 days.
And then all of a sudden I'm alive? Initially, they'd be happy. Then they'd get mad after they thought about it.
Yeah, I guess. You'd scare the hell out of them initially.
Yeah. Especially if it's a black funeral. A bunch of black people, I jump up out of the coffin.
Oh, that'd be good.
Or if some black chick starts wigging out and tries to get in the coffin with me, you just pull her in.
Well, come on. I was kidding. What was I going to say?
I don't know.
You were talking about having a will the other day. Have you ever? I mean, you really should. My dad, for instance, you know, had one stroke already, and so he had his complete funeral.
I'll just leave it all to Operation Kindness. I'll get Everett to do that. That way I ain't got to think about it. I don't care where
somebody's
it goes.
Got to plan your funeral, though. Somebody's got to get the box, get the burial site. I mean, that's normally things that...
I'm sure I could get that for free.
As you get along.
Maybe I could get all that stuff now. Maybe we could go through like a little mock ceremony. Let's have a funeral.
No.
Let's have a funeral before I die.
No.
It'll be fun. My mom will make the costumes.
No. Jesus. No.
Come on. Find someplace, have a funeral. Everybody can come out.
But they'll know you're not dead.
I know, but I just want to see what it'd be like. And I want people to get up there and talk about me and say how much I meant to them. And we'll play little montages and still images of all me with animals and stuff like that. Have a bunch of black people screaming.
I'll make one of the videos with some, like, you know, some song, some sappy song.
Yeah. Things like that. Something from the Goodbye Girl.
Where are you going to be this whole time?
I'll lay in a casket. Just so I can listen. Just so we can all get up.
No.
Where can we do this?
Like a wrestling place? Or are you talking about a... You're not going to do this.
You say wrestling or wrestling?
Restland.
Oh.
Like a real funeral home?
Well, somebody that would let us go.
They won't let you do that because there are going to be real people having funerals on a very somber occasion.
Ours would be somber.
Make it be somber if everybody knows you're still there. You're going to lay still for an hour?
Mm-hmm.
Box?
Mm-hmm.
Then we slam it and we bury it.
Leave the door open. I can sit up if I need some air. Have them make me up, put me in a nice suit.
Mm-mm.
Yeah. Somebody told me that they glue your lips shut.
No idea.
I think they glue up all your portals so you don't dribble.
I don't know.
That's what I heard.
I had a fraternity brother that was a, what do you call that? You got to get your body ready?
Mortician?
Thank you. I was thinking taxidermist. No, that ain't it. Mortician. Same thing. Just
I got it.
Yeah. So they drain you and they fill you, I think, halfway full of that other fuel.
Antifreeze?
Yeah. Something like that.
Press down. Nobody wants to freeze up.
I don't know if they seal you up or not.
That's what I want. Mock funeral. Let's go. We still got that casket, or we get rid of it?
I don't know. I thought we left it over the ticket.
Oh. Oh, yeah, that's right. Did they ever get in?
I don't think so.
What are you waiting on? Let me see.
I'm sure you could get another free casket if you wanted.
Yeah.
Or I don't know if we still have that one.
Dan, go through the phone lines. I'd like an entire funeral setup, please. Casket, place to do it. We'll even go out to the burial site.
You know, put the casket in the ground?
Yes.
And bury it?
Why not?
You still be in it?
No.
Okay. Those are expensive.
You don't follow these bits too well,
no,
do you?
I'm sorry. I'm really having a hard time with this one. Pardon me. I've never buried somebody alive.
Oh, please.
What?
All right.
Thought about it. Are you serious?
Yes.
Are you playing?
No. A nice big pre-funeral funeral.
Like on a weekend day?
Yeah.
Like a big sunny Saturday afternoon, we'll all go have a funeral and bury you.
Yes. Okay. Have a ceremony. People come up. They talk about me. Have a nice big picture of me right by the casket.
Okay. Oh, man, I wish you would die today. Hey. We need flowers, a casket, a place, and a reverend.
Yes.
That's all we need.
And a lot of people to talk about me.
Yeah.
And a bunch of black people to cry.
Okay. I think people will come out.
Yeah, why not?
Maybe print t-shirts. I attended Russ Martin's funeral.
Yeah. Russ Martin's first annual funeral.
There we go.
And then when I really die, that'll be the last one.
I like that.
Good.
Okay. Perfect.
Anybody call yet? Iffy? Okay. Hi, Liz.
Hi. Hello?
Yes.
Hi, Russ.
Hate to disturb your cocktail party. What can I do for you?
This is off the subject of your funeral. If you can remember back a couple of weeks ago, you were traveling in your Batmobile, and you were traveling in Addison, and there was a gentleman that pulled up on a Hayabusa. It was silver and polished.
Yes, I've never seen a polished camel.
A Hayabusa?
What is that?
It's a sports bike, like a street bike.
Okay.
Do you remember that at all?
Nope.
Oh. Well, Scott and I, he's a coworker. We're really slow right now. We are having a debate. And Scott was arguing the fact that you don't talk to anyone when you're in your Batmobile. And my boyfriend clearly remembers that you are the one that struck up the conversation. And I just wanted to prove Scott wrong. But if you don't remember the situation, it's no big deal.
I talk to people all the time when I'm in it. I can't keep track of it.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right. Have a good one.
All right. Bye. No, I do try and avoid it.
Mm-hmm. You do.
Turn the radio up loud. That way I can hear them.
Yeah. I know. I've been with you when they're screaming in my ear, trying to get your attention, and you're like,
can't hear it. White Snake's playing.
Mm-hmm. Was Motorhead that night, actually.
Oh, that's over, right. We ran that out.
Over and over and over and over.
You don't like the song?
I do. I love it. Like I said, I wish the whole album was like that. I'd buy the CD.
It's not. It's one of the few songs that's mainstream. Yeah. I don't even think I have Orgasmatron up here. If I did, I'd play it.
It'd scare you.
Not something you will listen to before you go to bed.
Pantera-ish?
Yes.
Okay.
Not quite as in tune.
Damn.
Yeah. All right, let me see here. How we doing, Eddie?
Getting close.
All right. I guess Everett's not coming today.
It's not.
Which is good. I couldn't take him after Dr. Natasha. It's a doubleheader.
Oh, she's fun.
Hi, Tracy. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Is this Russ Martin?
Yes.
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm fine.
I was just wondering, why are you always slamming big people?
They're ugly. They're disgusting. They're sweaty. They're nasty.
Wow. I mean, have you ever been that big? Or?
No.
Well, I mean, I'm not big. I'm just wondering why you're always slamming on people like that.
Gross.
Is it?
Yes.
Do you ever think maybe that skinny people are gross?
Only to fat people.
To fat people?
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Skinny is natural. Fat
is
gross.
It?
Yes.
I mean, I was just really curious because, I mean, some skinny people look really nasty.
Okay.
I mean, I was just curious. I mean, I don't know.
I understand.
Because, I mean, I've seen pictures of you and you're really skinny and you're not that cute.
I know. Of course, I don't have no idea what I look like. Every time I look in a mirror, there's a bitch in front of me. That was it?
Yeah, she
I didn't hang up on her.
She's gone.
Oh, I get it. She was expecting a reaction to the cute thing.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll mention that the next time I'm banging somebody.
Somebody emailed me today. Tell Russ to stop saying women over 50 aren't good for sex partners. We're very sexy.
No, you're not. There are some, but more often than not, no.
She goes, not going to be long. Both you can be over 50.
Yeah, I know, but we're still going to look better because guys age better than women.
I tried to explain that. She got ugly.
Oh, did she really?
A little snippy.
Well, what are they going to do?
I just said, it's just our society. Sorry.
Women age like dogs.
Yeah.
You're really hot for a short period of time.
Mm-hmm.
Next thing you know, you're not. Sorry if I got too deep there.
It was.
Guys age like humans. Women age like dogs. Look at them. Look at Tawny Katane. 10 years ago,
ooh,
she was a piece of ass. You look at her now in her mugshot.
Mm-mm. Dog years.
Yeah.
It doesn't whip everybody's ass. People like Goldie Hawn. She's done.
She's had a lot of plastic surgery.
On her face, has she?
Look how wide her mouth is. She's got the Vavoom syndrome.
What's that?
Where your head tilts all the way back. Looks like one of the kids from South Park. Starting to line people up already. Hi, Vonda.
Hey, Russ.
Yes.
Okay, you got to clarify that statement. That's white women.
White women what?
They age like dogs.
Yeah, you're right. Black people don't.
We don't.
Don't seem to age as quickly.
Why is that? She looks like my sister.
Could you stay out of the sun?
No, that's that brown skin.
Oh.
From the motherland.
Huh.
Anyway, I want to.
Obviously, if you have less stress in your life, then you don't.
Oh, hell no.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I've got more stress.
No, you don't.
I mean, you know, as being a black man, what the stress we go through. Come on.
Yeah, I suppose. When's it gonna wig out and swing me around?
I want to be at the funeral if I can.
Will you really?
Yeah.
Are you getting a casket with me?
Oh, hell yeah. I'm black, man. Come on. That's what we do.
And you got to wear the great big onion blossom hat. I don't even know where you get them.
I do.
Well, who's
this closet?
Who's...
Black suit, big hat, looks like a spaceship.
Yeah.
And just with the black handkerchief and start crying.
That's it.
Take me now.
I want to
go.
That's it.
So get the details. I'll make sure I'll be there.
Absolutely. This will be a grand event.
Love you, Russ.
Thank you. I love
Bye.
You, too. All right.
If you really want to do this, you're talking about a weekend then, like Saturday?
Yeah.
Okay.
Find some place to do it. We may not be able to do it in a cemetery or a, you know.
Oh, you need a hearse. We got to have all that stuff.
Get George, we can get a hearse.
Okay.
Get the limos from Ultimate Limousines. We're covered.
All right.
Funeral.
Funeral it is.
It'll be fun.
It'll be a blast. What do we do? How do we end it? You just get up and say, ha-ha, or we have to think of it.
Hey, that's good.
You like that? That's what I'm saying. How are you going to end it?
Wait. Explain to me again how you think it should end.
You want me to ruin the punchline?
No, say it again.
I can't.
Yes.
Some people didn't hear it. It'll be a surprise.
I just jump up and say, ha-ha. Is that right?
That's it.
Write that down.
Screwed up for everybody.
All right, he's got it in case anybody forgets. Now we know how to end.
Now we have to do something different. You have to say, ha-ha-ha.
How could today's show start out so bad and yesterday's was pretty good?
It was a great day. Today didn't start bad. You've come up with an idea already, a big promotion.
Where can we have this? Who would let us come out and do something like this?
I bet there's a funeral home somewhere that'll let us.
You think?
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't even have to be a good one.
Because they got 5-6 rooms. You know, there's always, in case they have real funerals, they'll have room for us.
Yeah. All right, good. Let me see this, and then we'll start news. Can we do news first, Daddy? All right. Yes, Jules?
Hey, if JD wants to get in shape, he needs to do the Bikram yoga.
Thought you were doing yoga.
I haven't started the class yet. What kind of yoga?
No, the Bikram yoga. You got to do the Bikram yoga.
Yes.
I don't know what that is.
It's you go in the room. They heat the room up to about 105 degrees.
Oh, I've heard this, yeah.
You do 45 minutes standing, 45 minutes floor work. And it will whoop you into shape as fast as lightning.
Why would you do that?
It keeps you balanced and flexible and strength. Gives you lots of strength. And all that stuff they're teaching you about your center core,
mm-hmm.
You don't need to get on a ball to do that. You can do it without being on a ball.
Well, she's a professional trainer that's been to school for this.
Yes, what do you do, Jules?
What do I do?
Yes.
It doesn't matter what I do.
What do you do for a living?
It doesn't matter what I do.
Really? Day or night?
I have a regular job.
Okay, and then what do you do at night?
Go to sleep.
Uh-huh. You don't dance anywhere?
No, sir.
What do you do?
I'm too old. I'm not getting into myself here. This is not,
what is
not
it you,
about me.
What is it you do?
I do Bikram yoga.
I know, but what do you do for a living?
I am a flight attendant.
Why are you embarrassed about that?
Because I don't...
Unless you're a man. Are you a man?
No, I'm not a man.
Well, then what are you embarrassed about?
I don't know. You should come do the Bikram yoga. You're
okay, right. I can't wait to do it. When is the next class?
There is classes tomorrow at 9:15.
And who does this?
You can come to Beltline in the Toll Road.
All right.
A studio at Addison.
Okay, I'll do that then.
Oh, come on now.
I will. Tomorrow night, what time?
I don't think you could get through the class.
Yes, I could. Tomorrow night at what time?
No, at noon.
Oh, at noon. No, I'm not doing it at noon.
Okay, well, there's a class at 6 o'clock.
I'll do that one then.
Okay.
All right, I'll see you at 6.
All right.
I'm excited.
Bye.
I wish it were then now.
105 degrees. That's as hot as the sauna.
That's stupid. You know what that is? It's people that don't want to get out and do something.
Yeah.
Instead of actually getting out in the summer and doing stuff and working, they want a simulated environment where they think they're doing something. Get a lawnmower and push it around for a half hour in the summer. I guarantee you, you'll sweat your ass off.
Yeah.
As soon as I get mine fixed, that's what I'm going back to doing. But my bowl's still stuck.
Go fix it.
I don't know how to fix it. I've shaken that thing back and forth. Still busted.
Lawnmower shop.
I don't have a way to tote it over there.
Mm.
Plus, my car's got a flat on it. Had to have the limo drive me in today.
Mm.
That's funny because I'm sitting in the back of the limo. I got KRLD playing, listening to the news, got the TV on because the Georgia's, they have broadcast TV.
Mm-hmm.
and I'm reading the paper, and just for an instant, I got sucked in.
You bought it?
Yeah. I went, I could do this every day. This would be cool. I like this.
The stress of traffic.
Yeah. Then I realized I didn't like it.
Why?
Because you start getting full of your own crap, and then you get too removed from reality, and then you turn into a freak.
Yeah.
It's nice every once in a while. I couldn't do that every day. All right.
So what happened? You're tired, you know?
I don't know. It was just flat. I came outside last night. It was about 9 o'clock, and I didn't have time to find out what it was. So it's still flat out there. During some of the breaks, I'm going to run outside and jack it up and change a tire and probably hurt myself. And then during another break, see if I can run to the gas station and get it fixed.
Okay.
But I'll do that.
Less.
I'm saying less anything.
Shut up. Okay.
Just let it play out. Hit the timer?
I did.
Good. 42. J.D. Ryan's on that live.
105.3. Thanks, Russ. Brought to us by SBC Communications and by the World Supercross. Wednesday, April 9th, 2003. Big day in world politics. The big Saddam Hussein statue fell over this morning. Jenna Jameson turned 29 today. Dennis Quaid is 49. Hal Ketchum, country singer, is 50. Hugh Hefner, 77. U.S. Marines helped Iraqis topple a 40-foot statue of Saddam Hussein in the main square of the Iraqi capital today, and a crowd danced on the fallen torso, tearing off his head and dragging it through the streets. U.S. Marines at one point covered the statue's head with the American flag, quickly removed the stars and stripes, and tied Iraqis' black, white, and red flag around Saddam's neck. After the crowd tried for more than an hour to bring down the statue themselves, the Marines stepped in to help with a big winch on a tank recovery vehicle. First pull brought the statue halfway down, dangling off its 25-foot pedestal as the crowd pelted it with garbage and shoes. Apparently, shoes is a big insult there. 21-year-old Marine from Fort Worth is among the latest killed in Operation Iraqi Freedom. An American flag and the Marine flag flew outside his family home. The Pentagon said Corporal Marty Medellin was killed when his...
I don't even think that's close.
Medellin.
Let me see.
M-E-D-E-L-L-I-N. Medellin.
I think he's Spanish.
Okay. How did that change the pronunciation?
Change the two Y's to to the L's to a Y. Try that.
Medellin?
You don't say the L's.
Medellin? Medellin?
That's pretty close.
Okay. Was killed when enemy fire struck the amphibious assault vehicle he was driving. The family's pastor said, that guy always wanted to be a Marine. A candlelight memorial will be at his house tonight. Maybe a good weekend to go. What?
Nothing. You changed them to a Y and still left the L's in there.
Medan? I thought two L's was a Y. And the Y you pronounce as E.
Well, it is, but you still left the L in there. Let me see the name. I saw a picture of him on the news. He looked Hispanic. That's probably something like Medellin. I'll bet.
Okay.
Somebody can call and correct me.
Okay. Sure they will.
Go ahead.
Yeah, maybe a good weekend to go shopping for a new car. Many dealerships planning hail sales after last weekend's storms. One dealership in Plano says about 200 of the cars on its lot were damaged. Now it plans to offer big savings on small dents. But if you may have trouble getting the car fully insured, many insurance companies won't offer comprehensive coverage on a new car with hail damage unless the damage is first repaired. And speaking of cars, we all know that Americans love their SUVs. But now that the war is on, people are going crazy for Hummers, the H2 models. General Motors is moving about 3,000 a month, making the Hummer the number one selling large luxury SUV. 51-year-old Sam Bernstein of Marin County, California, an owner of the big H2, says, quote, "When I turn on TV, I see wall-to-wall Humvees, and I am proud. They're not out there in Audi A4s. I'm proud of my country, and I'm proud to be driving a product that is making a significant contribution." Rick Schmidt, the founder of the International Hummers Owners Group,
I don't even know where to start with this guy.
There's another one. Rick Schmidt says, "Those who deface a Hummer in words or deed deface the American flag and what it stands for." I know, they're a little over the top with their hummies.
Never mind.
Okay. Rumor on the World Wide Web is that the Dixie Chicks were loudly booed by the audiences at the Flameworthy Awards on Monday night, but the CMT sound guys injected some canned applause into the audio feed, so the audience watching it on TV didn't realize the band was actually being booed. may or may not be true. That's just a rumor.
Got it.
Carmen Electra is in the news again. She's in negotiations to join the cast of the Warner Brothers picture big screen adaptation of the classic 70s police action series Starsky and Hutch that went into production today. Ben Stiller and Owen Wilson will star as the cop duo who raced around the city in a bright red hot rod and reported to their never-happy boss. And who will be Huggy Bear? Snoop Doggy Dogg.
Yes.
You're right. Is the duo's flamboyant street informant. And Electra will play Hutch's girlfriend. And let's see, cut number one. I'll do that later. Cut number two. Mm-hmm. Ghosts of the Abyss opens in this Friday in selected IMAX 3D and large format theaters. Academy Award winning director James Cameron journeys back to the site of the legendary wreck of the Titanic. Here in cut number two, Bill Paxton says, when he thought about James Cameron's invitation to explore the Titanic, he realized he may never get that chance again.
I've done a lot of reckless things in my life, but I've got kids now, and they, you know, they can't support themselves. Well, they're probably going to have to. So I thought, you know, do I really need to do this? Do I need to put myself in this kind of harm's way? But there's also that part of you that, I mean, this was the opportunity of a lifetime.
There we go. Bill Paxton also says in cut number three, finding out they were going to dive to the Titanic caused crew members to change their behavior.
I remember the Ken announced a few people for this dive, and we happened to be having lunch, and it was really animated at lunch. Everyone's talking, and the people who ended up going on the dive were particularly animated, and after their days are lunch, they quietly left about 5 minutes later. I didn't see them the rest of the day. I think each person, no matter who you are, you have to make some kind of peace with yourself or your God or whatever before you go in there.
Oh, shut up. The same guy that they turned into a Yoda in a Weird Science, wasn't it? You remember that?
Yeah. He's from Fort Worth.
Good. You're the fly eater.
See? Yeah. The Good Thief is also coming out. It's going to be up in select markets. Nick Nolte's back. He lives in the Twilight Zone with The Nice Underworld, a seedy universe blurred by drugs and gambling binges. A casino heist with the help of two accomplices might be his only chance to double down.
Now that sounds great. That was about the movie.
Number four, Nick Nolte was asked, listen to him, was asked if the fact that his character has to deal with drug addiction is what interested him in The Good Thief, as Nolte talks about his recent drug arrests.
I walk in the top of the roof and I see the thief. The engine falls down fast, and after that, the bundle, the truck go all the way in.
Nick Nolte was asked also how his battle with drugs is going, and he answers kind of tongue-in-cheek. That's cut number five.
I walk in the top of the roof and I see the thief. The engine falls down fast, and after that, the bundle, the truck go all the way in.
That's not him.
Yeah. I think that's probably one of the reasons the script appealed to me. And
is he answering?
Art does imitate.
Is he answering the drug question here?
Yeah, this is about his recent drug arrest. Is that what attracted him to this role? Because it's kind of similar to his deal.
Am I doing cut four or five?
Cut number four, I guess, first.
Yeah, I think that's probably one of the reasons the script appealed to me. And art does imitate life. You know, in a way. Now, of course, you know, you all saw the television pictures. I think of one of my finest performances.
Cut number five, Nick Nolte was asked how his battle with drugs is going, and he answers kind of tongue-in-cheek.
Fine. I got drunk as a skunk this morning. That's why you can hardly talk. No, I'm doing real good. Yeah, I'm in the program. I went to rehab and all that, which is great because, you know, it's always a new beginning. It's fresh.
Yeah, you sound fresh.
That's what I was thinking. Finally, Nick Nolte says he's grateful, actually, for his arrest on cut number six.
You're kidding.
He says, I'm glad I got arrested. It was a good thing.
You think they could at least, good God, man, give him a comb.
That was the greatest picture.
Not only is his hair styled exactly like Bill the Cat, he's got on a Bill the Cat shirt. Hawaiian shirt.
Yeah.
Really, the only thing that was missing was his tongue hanging out of his mouth.
Ah! You know, I had years and years and years of sobriety. And
you want credit for that? You didn't slip.
Being out on the road drunk. Driving is not particularly a good thing at all.
Well, he certainly sees the damage that he's done. I thought he was on some kind of drugs.
Yeah, he was.
Well, he just said drunk.
And he's on. Go ahead. There it is. That's coming out. Good, the Good Thief with Nick and Nolte. He's back. All right, there's news and information. I'm J.D. Ryan, the Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin Show. On Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas. We're back to the Russ Martin Show on Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas.
That rocks Texas.
Texas. Sounds like somebody got a Casio for Christmas.
Yeah.
Never heard this version.
I mean, where'd you get it?
I don't know. It's loaded in the computer.
Oh.
I don't do this stuff. I was playing this the other night when I was driving around in the Batmobile.
Yeah.
There's something very surreal about that.
Yes. Moment of clarity.
I don't think that's what it is.
That's alive. There's a cool rap version from that movie.
Yeah, we played it on the air.
That's kind of cool.
Yeah. Yeah, the Return to the Batcave remix. I forget who did it. I have that in the car, too.
All right.
Anybody call about my flat yet? Somebody has called? They're coming up. Fix it. Huh?
They said they were willing. I can call them and have them come up if you want.
Well, make sure it's like a gas station or something. Don't just let some guy come up.
Can't I fix a flat?
I tried that last night.
Uh-huh.
Didn't work. I don't know. It came out all over my hands.
Okay.
I don't know why. It was dark. It was cold.
I guess. You attached it all the way onto the little cap?
Oh, are you supposed to do that?
No, but I mean, where did it come out?
It came out of the very top. You know where you push it down and it feeds into the tire? It's coming out all over my hands.
Gross.
You can still smell it.
Yeah.
You can.
I believe you.
No, that's Katana.
Oh,
it may be this
God.
Hand. Yeah, it's his hand.
Okay, I don't want to prefer to smell the other one.
Here.
Mmm.
Yeah. It smells like SARS.
I was going to say.
Not only is she the hottest Asian woman I've ever met, she's one of the hottest chicks I've ever met.
She is very.
It's just too bad she's married.
Mm.
It's very sad. I wonder if her husband would let me if I let him watch.
You never know what they're into.
He's
in that business, so he's already different than the average guy if he can put up with that business.
She's not having sex with people.
I know.
She just models.
I know.
Nobody knows what happens in those little modeling rooms there at the...
Yeah, but she models, but she says guys see the, you know, the glam. So.
Mm. That reminds me. Hi, Gail.
Hi.
What? Dang. Well, I did.
Yeah.
That was a smooth transition.
Yes. All right. 403. Did you do a legal ID? All right. Gail Lightfoot's here with traffic.
All right, sir. Traffic is brought to you by CareerBuilder.com and Car Toys. On westbound I-30, coming out of Dallas toward Grand Prairie, you've got road work in the left lane at Industrial, right there at the Trinity River Bridge, and traffic's backed up onto Simmons and through the canyon. And in just north of downtown Dallas, on eastbound Woodall Rogers at Central, to go northbound on Central, there's road work in the right lane. It's been backed up across North Dallas all the way to I-35 Simmons. Now, in Fort Worth, there's a crash on eastbound I-30 at 287. That one's in the right lane. And if you're traveling in Grapevine, there's a signal light problem. All along 121, the signal lights are completely out on 121 between Highway 26 and Freeport Parkway, and the crews are working on it. Also, the lights out at FM 2499 and Stars and Stripes Way. And this is also brought to you by Argosy University. Their bachelor's degree completion and graduate programs in psychology and counseling can help you help others. Call 214-890-9900 for upcoming information sessions or for campus tours. I'm Gail Lightfoot with traffic on Live 105.3, the Talk That Rocks Texas.
Thank you, Gail.
What?
I can tell what you're
saying. That's a funny hat.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, 38 for the overnight low. It's still kind of chilly and warming up by tomorrow. It should be mid-70s and up into the 80s for the weekend. We are at 60 degrees now at Live 105.3, the Talk That Rocks, Texas.
All right. I looked at some of the emails that come into the studio. Looks like we've got bagpipes for the funeral.
Very nice.
Some guy, I'm the pipe major of the Scottish Rite Pipes and Drum. I'd be honored to help you celebrate your first annual passing. Might I suggest something like Amazing Grace, followed by AC/DC's It's a Long Way to the Top.
Perfect.
Or Do You Think I'm Sexy by Rod Stewart. All right, that one's there. And then here's a guy with a hearse. Having the funeral. Do it at the Coward Funeral Home in Midlothian. Is that a real place?
I don't know. I've heard of it, yeah.
Coward?
That's the name, yes. Family name.
That's not very smart.
Mm-mm.
It's like when they used to call that hospital Deadman.
Yes.
I don't go to a hospital named Deadman. That's a scary.
There's a Chevy dealership in Houston called Gay Chevrolet, and the back, right on the back of your car just says Gay.
I don't think I'd like that. Just... They fill your trunk up with Dookie?
No.
Sorry, the doors are welded shut. You gotta go into the trunk.
What was the one we used to have over on Mockingbird? The family name was Fag, F-A-G-G.
Mm-hmm.
And just for whatever reason, they decided to go in the ball-bearing business.
Fag ball-bearing?
I swear to God.
Mm. Well, maybe the Coward people will bury me.
Or... What if we could do it out of... I don't know. I guess it's locked up since Lance Pope died at the Verdun Manor.
That's too far out.
Oh, okay.
That's out in Terrell.
Okay.
I want to have it someplace equidistant. I want all my fans to be able to come and bury me.
Okay.
Pay tribute. I want to see how many people would show up.
Interesting.
Everybody else had big funerals.
Mm-hmm. Most of them after they die, though.
I know, but it's a waste of time. It's like what I said with Coach Tom Landry. They should have named that freeway after him. They should have changed Texas Stadium to Landry Stadium before he died, or even before they even thought about it. Why wait till he dies to pay tribute to him? Now he didn't even know. He didn't know.
You're right.
One of the most humble men that you'd probably ever meet. When they had the parade for him after the Cowboys crap canning, he was afraid nobody was going to show up.
Yeah.
And what do they do after he's dead? Oh, let's give him a freeway. Well, aren't you timely? Always wait for somebody to crap before you tell them how much they meant to you. I want people to tell me that now.
Okay. Well, I'll get little speeches, eulogies.
I want the bagpipes to play.
That's great.
I want people to cry. I want the Negroes to negrate.
Okay. See what you can do about that.
Thank you. Okay. Whatever black people do at funerals.
All right.
Yes, Mandy?
Hey, Russ. I just wanted to let you know that I was listening to Mark Davis today on WBAP.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what I noticed? Mm-hmm. How well he treats his callers.
Hmm.
Even the ones who don't agree with him.
Mm-hmm.
He lets them...
I guess we could do it at Jay Gilligan's in Arlington.
Yes.
That's kind of equidistant.
Perfect.
Everybody could come. Have it in the parking lot. The weather's nice.
Mm-hmm.
Have it on a Saturday. Have the casket right out in the middle.
Won't be as sad if it's not actually a funeral home. Where
yeah,
you
you're right.
Everything.
Yeah, where everybody has to come in and park and you have right. to be quiet. Yeah, we'll see if we can get somebody to do that.
Okay.
You're right. It needs to be in that environment.
Yeah.
Or it kind of loses the magic.
Right.
She call back? Line four? Yes, Mandy.
You know what? You could just give me a chance, okay?
To
what? He reacts and he carries on an insightful, intelligent conversation with him.
Mm-hmm.
He understands that just because someone disagrees, it doesn't make him wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Why can't you do that?
Hello?
Yes.
So what's your...
Oh, we're going to have pallbearers.
Ooh. Well, you've got us.
Mm-mm.
Why?
Mm-mm.
Why?
Mm-mm.
Well, you're already there. Where are we going to carry you?
Hey, I could be one of my own pallbearers.
No.
And then as we set the casket down, I get in it.
Well, actually, it's already there when it starts. The pallbearers carry you to the car.
Oh.
For the burial.
Well, I could get out and help.
And then carry you off to the gravesite.
You guys would drop me.
Mm-mm.
Yes, you would. The hell you wouldn't.
Nah. We won't drop you. Oh, I talked to Larry from my engineering department.
Yes.
We still have the casket.
Oh, we do?
It's in the rolling stereo studio.
Perfect. All right. Yes, Mr. Trenholm?
I think I have your tire situation.
Who's going to fix it?
Mark with Road Adventures said he towed the Batmobile.
Yes.
Okay, he's going to come down here. He'll change your tire.
Yes.
He'll take the tire to get it fixed. Then he'll come back and he'll put the spare on.
Yes.
And then come back and come to your house.
Why does he have to put a spare on it? Why can't he just stick it on a cinder block while he's gone? That's what I do.
Yes, I know. In your front yard.
And then he said he'd come to your house tomorrow and put it back on. If that would work for you.
Put it back on. Well, it's just a gas station up at the corner. Just needs a plug.
Okay. Then I'll have him...
Yeah.
Get it plugged.
He ain't gonna charge me, is he?
Well, he was gonna take it to a place where he could get it done free, but that's not close to here, but...
It's just plugging. Yeah. I can plug it myself. I just didn't have time to take it off.
I guess I'll just go do it during a break. That's okay.
Is he gonna charge me?
No.
Well, I can get the Batmobile charged, towed for free. But that's okay. Is he coming?
Yes.
Yes, that'll be fine.
Okay.
I can go get it fixed now.
Okay.
He just got a free plug.
Okay.
Thank you. Road Avengers. Mm-hmm. I thought it was kind of cool them towing the Batmobile.
Yeah.
Again? What is it, Mandy?
See, that's what I'm talking about. You don't let anyone ever finish.
So you want me to be nice to people?
Yes.
Let me explain the difference, if I might.
Okay.
I might be so bold.
Okay.
Mark Davis is a man of compassion.
Mm-hmm.
He's a man of fairness. He likes everyone to walk away a winner. When somebody calls up with an opposing view, he likes to try and let them discuss their point. He discusses his point, and hopefully each side understands each other's version a slightly slight bit before they go off in their different directions.
So what's so wrong with that?
I don't care what you think.
Why?
Because you're idiots.
I listen to you.
Exactly.
I support you.
Exactly.
You can at least listen to what I have to say.
No.
You're a jerk.
I know. And you're listening. What does that make you? Huh? What does that make you? What does that make you?
An idiot.
Thank you.
Very nice. See, everybody walked away a winner. She realized she was an idiot and you called her one.
Right. Mark Davis wants everybody to get their say.
Yes.
He's a fair and just man. I'm not.
No.
Mark Davis's show is a reflection of
a myriad of attitudes and...
No! It's a cluster.
No, it's not. I've heard him argue with people that are vehemently opposed to him.
And I understand, but he lets them get their say, right?
Yes.
I don't have time for that.
Okay.
That's why I'm fabulously wealthy and he's doing foundation repairs.
All right.
You can't do that. His show isn't reality. Everybody doesn't always get to say their view.
Well, I'm
and discuss it, you know, fairly back and forth. That ain't reality. This is reality. This is the real world. This is life.
Yes. Most talk.
He's broadcasting from Disneyland every day.
Yes.
Where everybody wants you to say your piece. He encourages you to call in. Mm-hmm. He gives a phone number every 8 seconds.
He does. Most talk shows do.
I don't. I figure if you got something important enough to say, you can pay a dollar, call information, get the phone number, and call up. I'm not going to give it to you. You don't deserve it. I've been trying for years to get it unlisted.
I know.
He lets people talk far too long. I was listening to him today on the treadmill.
Mm-hmm.
And there was some guy that disagreed with him. Talked to him for almost 5 minutes.
Yep.
And they both ended the phone call very politely, very cordially.
Mm-hmm.
That's a crock.
It works for his kind of radio. It's different.
Yes.
He's very jealous of you.
You don't know that.
I do know that. He told me so at the Christmas party.
Was he drunk?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, what'd he say?
I wish I could get on and say those things that Russ says.
Why can't he say it?
He can't. It's ABC Disney. You said Disneyland. You're right. It's ABC Disney Radio. It's Happy Land.
Well, you don't have to be ugly to people, but you don't have to take the crap. Well, when somebody calls up and calls him an idiot, you go, fine. Who's the one with the radio show? Lick.
That's not his style. His style is to be, let everybody say their point, even if you disagree.
That's retarded.
Yeah.
Makes me sick to think about it.
Yeah, just one day, you ought to try to do that. Let anybody call in and get their opinion. Even if they disagree with you, you promise not to hang up on anybody one day.
I just got dizzy.
Sorry.
Let me think about that for a second. I'm still dizzy.
I apologize. Bad idea. Wash it out of your mind.
No, it's very intriguing.
Yes. You can't hang up on anybody for just one day.
Now the room is spinning. Hold on a second. This is very fascinating.
You couldn't do it.
All right, how about this?
Okay.
At one point, what is today, Wednesday?
Yes.
At one point, either today or tomorrow, we'll set aside. Will you stop moving?
I'm sorry. I'm excited. This is going to be fun.
We'll set aside a minute.
A minute?
All right, 15 minutes.
1 hour.
Okay, how about 15 minutes?
All right.
Thank you. Never a very good negotiator.
I bet you can't make it 15 minutes, but go ahead.
15 minutes. We'll do it just like a regular talk show. People will call in. I might even give the phone number. And everybody gets to say their piece. Nobody gets hung up on. I don't call anybody bad names. I listen to their point of view. I'm really getting sick.
I'm sorry. Every phone conversation has to end with a joint meeting and hello and goodbye, goodbye.
Got it. I can't even make it out of the room now. I got vertigo.
Sorry for the idea, even. It would be fun to see if you could do it, though.
15 minutes either today or tomorrow.
Okay.
Depending on how today goes. Okay. Yes, Michael?
Hey, I got a suggestion for you.
Mm-hmm.
Last week you were talking about how you could cover three topics over a four-hour show,
mm-hmm.
Like Mark Davis does.
Mm-hmm.
So I was suggesting to see if you could try that.
One topic for a whole hour?
Yeah.
Nobody does that. That never happens in real life. That's retarded. Well, this is real life. This is not fantasy land. You ain't playing miniature golf and you ain't shooting a ball through a windmill. Get off it. I'm not going to be able to do this.
I know you're not. It's going to be fun to watch you suffer, though.
Would we like to throw some cash down on this?
No, because if there's money, you'll do it. It'll be hard. I mean,
I know, but if there's cash on it, then you guys can throw in some ringers. Things I wouldn't suspect.
Oh.
Things I wouldn't plan on.
Ooh.
Things that you know that are going to push my buttons.
$100.
Okay, you want some of this, Dan? Hold up fingers. How many? How many dollars you want? 10?
Eddie, in or out? 5, in or out?
I can't make it 15 minutes?
Uh-huh. And it has to be 15 minutes of talking. 7 of that can't be commercials. Sorry.
Yes, Mr. Trenholm?
I'd like 20, please.
So nobody thinks I can make it to 15 minutes?
No.
Okay. And if we're going to do it like a regular talk show,
mm-hmm.
there'll have to be a topic.
Okay.
I don't like that.
Why fat women are sexually attractive.
Which side am I on?
Obviously, you're on your side, which is, no, they're not.
Okay.
I'm just trying to think of something that makes you cringe.
I don't like topics.
Okay.
We'll just take calls.
Okay.
It's about all I can stomach. You're in for 20, Trey?
Mm-hmm.
Eddie, 5. JD, 100.
$100.
O'Malley, 20.
You going to go up? 20? All right.
I'll cover all those bets.
Okay.
I think perhaps we'll wait until tomorrow.
Okay.
Right now I have the whiskey spins. Just the idea makes me sick.
I understand.
Hi, Ed.
I've got $100 to the Fireman's Foundation that says you can't last 15 minutes.
All right, fine. Leave your name and phone number and we'll contact you.
Okay, just a JD?
Yeah.
Where did you get the GPS locator for your girlfriend's car?
I got it.
Did you hit it too?
I didn't hit it.
No. Oh, I hit it twice. All right, we're down to 2 seconds, so nobody say anything. I think I got it all.
Thank you.
I totally forgot about that. I'm sorry. I didn't see that one.
I didn't either. Nothing.
Dan, let me know if any of that made it on the air. All right, thank you.
Break here, Eddie?
Please.
All right.
Jesus.
We'll be back on KLLI, Dallas Fort Worth. Certainly enjoy the conversation. There's more to come. Can you imagine?
You ain't gonna make it.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin Show. Russ Martin Show. We're back to the Russ Martin Show.
Russ Martin Show.
On Live 105.3. The talk that rocks Texas.
The talk that rocks Texas.
Oh, that's cold.
One of the sales chicks that was banging about 6 weeks ago from my office, and I was pounding her. She goes, "Does anybody know we're having sex?" Or just the people I told.
And the people they told.
Oh, man. Has your cell phone gone off yet?
I haven't checked it.
Okay.
I see by the email that it hit it, it got on the air.
I hit it twice.
Okay.
We went down to...
Can we drop it?
I'm not going to say what it is.
Okay.
But I hit the delay twice. We went down to 2 seconds. I peeled off 6 seconds off the signal. Yes, obviously they did.
It's a bit.
Maybe they didn't hear about it. Or maybe she didn't hear it. Perhaps nobody else where she works is going to go tell her either.
Mm-mm.
Maybe we have my funeral on a Friday. Okay. And Sunday I can push the big rock.
Okay, I got it. Roll the bat rock away from the cave.
Yeah.
Okay.
I sure would like to get that thing home, but it kind of looks cool out there in the lobby.
I like it there, too, but you got a spot in the backyard that's perfect for it. It's just a matter of getting it there. It's going to take a moving or construction company to move that thing.
What happened to the construction company that was going to put the great big yellow ribbon on the broadcast tower? Did they vanish, Dan? Yeah. Do what?
You hung up on him.
I know, but he didn't call back?
No, he never did. And the number I had given to Trey of the construction company in Carrollton turned out to be a different guy.
Hmm. It was an accident when I hung up on it.
I know. I mean, I'll buy the stuff if we just get somebody with a chair.
Do you know what it's going to cost to put up or just to have a 30-foot yellow ribbon made?
Well, I'm just thinking it's just going to be of cloth and just wrap it around. It doesn't have to be fancy.
Oh, I see. I'm thinking about it like a bow. You're just talking about just a great big yellow cloth.
Just a yellow cloth wrapped around.
Well, it's not quite as...
Well, it's not as, but it's not as expensive either.
I suppose. Mm-hmm. What are we about to do? Oh, we're about due for news again, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
It's been about an hour.
Yep.
And don't let me forget, we're having dinner with the firemen on Friday.
Okay. Since we get off.
Yeah. Maybe you can do two promos Thursday night. That way it's already done for Friday and we immediately leave.
Okay.
Because from what I hear, the firemen like to eat at 6.
Okay.
But they're right around the corner.
I will do that.
All right. You ready for news?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Really, I hit the delay twice. I thought I got it.
You didn't.
You saw me hit it?
I'll handle it. On my end. It'll be fine.
I didn't say it.
I know you didn't.
I didn't know he was going to say it.
No, I didn't either. He was going some other way, and that's fine, but thank you for trying to get it off.
Okay. Here we go. All right. 432, J.D. Ryan's on the
live full live 105.3. Thank you, Rust. News is brought to us by Carrabba's Italian Grill. And let's see, Saddam Hussein's rule over the capital has ended. U.S. commanders declared today, and jubilant crowds swarmed into the streets, dancing, looting, and cheering U.S. convoys. A Marine tank recovery vehicle helped residents topple a towering statue of Saddam in a sweeping symbolic gesture. And the most visible signs of Saddam's evaporating power, the towering statue of the Iraqi president was brought down in the middle of the square. Cheering Iraqis, some waving national American flags, scaled the statue, danced upon it, and drug his head down the street.
Hold on a second. Where did these Dallas Stars tickets come from?
Listener dropped those off. They're for, I believe, tonight's playoff game. And he said that you can auction them off and put the money into the Police and Firefighters Foundation.
It's for tonight?
I believe the tickets are. Look at them.
Section 111, row WC10.
Here's Trey.
These are $90 a piece?
Yes.
Round one, home game one. That didn't say the date. Just says date and time TBA. Where these come from?
A listener. He wanted a T-shirt in exchange. He donated those to Operation Kindness.
They didn't have a date on it. You got hosed. It says date and time TBA.
Well, if you have, like, they issue tickets before they announce.
It's tonight, round one, home game one?
Yes.
Well, we don't have time to auction these off. I realize these were $90 a piece.
Mm-hmm.
The good seats.
Is it? Row W, seat 10?
And
well, they come up here with the cash, I guess.
Oh, I see. Here's a little map.
Yep.
110, row W, seat 10. I guess it's a good spot. I don't know what's a good spot with hockey.
You get Stars Club with those and parking pass, everything.
Oh, is that what this is?
Yep.
2003 playoff green, good for this date only. Home game one. All right, Dan, if anybody calls these... What time's our office close?
5:30.
Yeah. They got till 5:30 to get up here with cash. Thanks for letting me know about it. Nip.
More good news out of Baghdad as U.S. troops rumbled into the northeast part of the city. 150 children were apparently released from prison, according to Lieutenant Colonel Fred Padilla. The kids were jailed for refusing to join the youth branch of Saddam's Ba'ath Party, and some of them have been held for up to 5 years. The colonel says, quote, hundreds of kids were swarming us and kissing us. Their parents were running up, so happy to have their kids back. And many other Iraqis in Baghdad celebrating their newfound freedom the old-fashioned way, by looting the most popular items, guns, furniture, air conditioning units, all from government compounds. What is that? Yeah? A Ba'ath Party?
Thank you.
Okay. U.S. generals say that the Iraqis have booby-trapped pockets of the city. The traps include rocket-propelled grenades that are rigged to fire at passing vehicles, bombs carried in cars and trucks that are left at random intersections, and decapitation wires strung across city streets. Despite such sobering thoughts, you might enjoy this little bit of courtesy, courtesy of Iraqi's ambassador to the Arab League. He says, quote, Iraq has already achieved victory apart from some technicalities. That's what he said.
Okay.
Former police officer pleaded guilty yesterday to charges that he forced four women to strip naked after he pulled them over for traffic violations. Frank Wright forced one of the women to walk home wearing only her underwear.
Oh, who's stupid enough to strip naked for a traffic stop?
If it's a cop and tells you to.
No, you don't. You don't take your clothes off.
These girls did. He pleaded guilty to civil rights violations, carrying up to 5 years and 3 months in prison. Several women say they were driven to isolated locations.
That's more than just making somebody strip.
Yes.
That's rape.
Sometimes in handcuffs, after they were stopped by Wright, some were released without being forced to disrobe.
That's jacked.
Yeah.
It is. You're a cop and you take advantage of a chick like that. I mean, there's one thing to hit on them and go, you know, look, maybe if you know, say, you roll down the window some more, you do this, I might let you go. But, I mean, to drive somebody around?
Yeah.
Chicks are scared of cops to begin with. That's right. And what did they give him?
They have not sentenced him yet. He could get, he pleaded guilty to up to 5 years and 3 months in prison.
Oh, that's not enough.
It's not.
Mm-mm.
Well, he apparently didn't hurt any of them, but
There's still an emotional stress. That's like a mental rape. One time I got arrested, I didn't like it.
Where was this?
In Tarrant County.
Oh.
Just a whole handcuff thing in the back of the car?
I can imagine.
If he wanted to, he could have stuck his head through that window thing and started kissing me. I was scared of that, too.
I doubt anybody of police officer nature would kiss you.
Well, you don't know. Look, this guy, he drove those chicks off and made them take their clothes off.
That's true.
I just don't like that.
Mm-mm. I remember we shooting the TV show that time at the Seagoville jail, and they closed the cell door.
Mm-hmm.
That's a scary. And I knew I wasn't in trouble, and it was still scary.
I didn't like it when I was locked up for a couple hours. The only upside was I was watching guys get the snot beat out of them. We weren't even in Garland.
On the eve of the Masters, Hootie Johnson refused to back down once again on the issue of women members, saying he will not change his mind and that the controversy will not damage the tournament. With more than 60 green-jacketed members standing by in silent support, the Augusta National chairman said the club is united in the belief and the right to choose its own members. Johnson also rejected a suggestion that Tiger Woods or any other past champion could influence members to change their minds. I won't tell Tiger how to play golf if he doesn't tell me how to run my private club.
He's got a point. You don't have to let people in.
No. You don't want women there.
I don't understand why, but my club, I can do whatever I want.
Okay, finally, remember the class action lawsuits that was filed against Lowe's movie theater chain showing commercials after the advertised starting time of the movie? Well, there happens to be a decent-sized chain out there that can proudly proclaim no commercials at the beginning of their movies. Talking about Century Theaters. If you have one near you, you should give them your business. Century Theater is run by two brothers, Raymond and Joseph. They say, we've been showing movies and only movies to the public since 1941 when our father started this business. We feel that movie going is unique. An exciting experience that should have no relationship to sitting at home and watching television. We want you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Century Theaters currently owns 900 screens. Sadly, only 11 states. California, Arizona, Nevada, New Mexico, Alaska, Colorado, Illinois, Oregon, South Dakota, Utah, and yes, Texas. So find one near you. There's news and information. I'm J.D. Ryan on Live 105.3, Talk Rocks, Texas.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin. We're back to the Russ Martin Show.
Russ Martin Show.
On Live 105.3. The talk that rocks Texas.
Talk that rocks Texas.
All right, 4:45. Check on traffic with the lovely Gail Lightfoot.
Thank you very much. This is brought to you by Car Toys. In Dallas, on southbound 35 Simmons at Royal, there's a wreck off to the right shoulder, but traffic is backed up past 635 all the way to Beltline in Carrollton. On westbound I-20 at Great Southwest Parkway, a wreck in Grand Prairie that may be off to the right shoulder now. You got road work causing a big mess downtown Dallas. This is on eastbound Woodall Rogers right at 75 Central in the right lane. It's backed up across downtown to I-35 Stemmons. On eastbound 635 at TI Boulevard, it says an object in the roadway in the right lane. We just don't know what the object is. And southbound 635 at Town Center Boulevard. In Mesquite, there's a stalled car. It's just off to the right shoulder of the roadway. And this is also brought to you by Pep Boys. Come into Pep Boys today and get free shock installation or up to $50 off strut installation. See store for details. Pep Boys, the car people. I'm Gail Lightfoot with traffic on Live 105.3, the talk of Rocks, Texas.
Thank you, Gail. Going to be cool again tonight. Going to be about 38 for the overnight low. Then warming up mid-70s tomorrow, mid-80s by the weekend. 62 degrees currently. Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas.
Mm-hmm. All right. Looking to see what I got here. All right. Dan, did anybody call for the hockey tickets?
Yeah, a few people.
How much money did they offer?
They didn't, actually.
What'd they say?
They said how much and when, that.
You know how much? Make an offer.
That's what I told him.
These things go for $90 a piece. It's $180, plus you got a parking pass. I don't know what that costs, but that's got to be another $10, $15.
That's what I told him. And I said, of course, anything more which goes into the foundation would be appreciated.
Yeah. All right, thanks. Do I want to go to this?
It'd be very exciting. Stars playoffs? Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Would you want to go?
I'd love to go.
Didn't say what time it starts.
I could find that out.
We don't have to find out now. Yeah, if nobody calls, nobody gets up here in time, then we'll just stick a couple hundred dollars in the foundation and
okay.
We'll go.
I'll have it with you.
There's parking. Okay. Comes Nipple Boy. Yes! What is it?
Trey. 6:30 is what time it starts.
Do we miss a whole lot? Do they run ads at the beginning, like going to movies?
It starts a little bit late. I mean, you'd miss probably the first period.
Period's only half an hour?
Well, actually, it's probably an hour, but by the time you...
Get down there. Oh, we got to go through traffic, too.
Well, most people will already be parked by then.
Oh, yeah.
It's the good news.
Hmm.
Time we get in. Maybe George can run us down because he parks close.
Yeah. So we only miss one period?
Mm-hmm.
That's all right. Mm-hmm. Okay, fine. Thank you.
Could have called on the two-way and just told me it started at 6:30.
No.
Had to come in here.
You want to.
He likes coming in here.
The hell is with him and the turtlenecks?
It's cold outside.
It's not cold outside. Makes him look queer. He's already got the queer haircut. He looks like that queer from 6 feet under.
Oh.
He does. The white one.
Yes, I understand.
You're welcome. Hello, Michael.
Russ.
Yes, sir.
You watched the war?
Yeah.
On TV?
Yeah.
Did you see it today with that video of the Marine guy? He's sitting on his tank he's sitting around like blowing bubbles, man. Just checking it out.
Did you really?
Yeah. Just casually, he had a little thing, dipping in. Blowing bubbles, just hanging out.
Looks like an idiot.
Blowing bubbles?
Yeah, just relaxing.
What the hell is he doing blowing bubbles?
He's just chilling out, like throwing a football or anything else.
Where do you get bubble stuff?
Probably somebody sent it to him in a care package. I'm thinking his parents.
Why would they send bubble stuff? You talking about the soap stuff?
Yeah, soap.
He looked very relaxed.
Well, they were throwing a football the other day.
No, I didn't. Well, they could be throwing a... Watch. All right, so the guy's... Well, no, I missed that.
I just think that's bizarre. I mean, he looked like an idiot.
I don't care what he's doing.
Well, I care. It makes the rest of the world think that we're all idiots. I mean, if we're all like this guy, just sitting around blowing bubbles, man.
We don't care what the rest of the world thinks. The hell, why would we start now?
Because everybody else...
Russia and France, they've already turned their backs on us. One of the latest rumors that is Saddam somehow made it into Russia or he's someplace and they're hiding him.
So how much worse do we want it to get? I mean, everybody...
What do we care?
We're a bunch of
the most powerful country on this planet. What do we care what anybody else thinks?
Mass destruction, and then everybody hates us. They start ganging up.
Let them hate us.
No, we walked right into Baghdad, and we didn't even break a... The point is, we walked...
Yes, we did break a sweat. Anytime you have anybody die, we broke a sweat.
I know, my point is, they're just relaxed. It was a lot easier to get in than they thought it would be. Even all the officers say that. They met very little resistance.
I thought some of the news reports said they had more resistance than they planned on.
I heard one of the guys in Baghdad say, we got here quicker than we thought.
They said that once the initial insertion in, when they went in, it seemed so easy, and then they hit some of the worst resistance they've had.
All right, explain that.
I'm just telling you what I saw the guy say today in downtown Baghdad, next to the little statue.
Well, Rumpelstiltskin said there were some times that they met resistance they weren't planning on. And what do you care if he's blowing bubbles?
Would you get a load of the guy?
I didn't see it.
I mean, he looks like one of those guys who was calling in about...
He could have a water wiggle. I don't give a flying F.
He just makes the rest of us...
They could be playing Twister, Mystery Date. They could all have slinkies.
It's the same thing as the space shuttle. It makes us look like a bunch of...
We didn't blow up the space shuttle on purpose. That was an accident.
Yeah, but the guy's blowing bubbles on purpose. He's sitting out there making...
He's relaxing. You know what? If you go, you could blow snot bubbles as far as I care. If you're going to go all the way over there, you're going to go through everything they've done, sleep in the sand, you get sand in your butt crack. Mm-hmm. You want to sit around and blow bubbles? Blow them.
I guess that's a point.
Thank you. Yes, Mike?
Hey, Bob.
Yes, sir?
That was actually...
By the way, I like that. I want everybody to start addressing me just like that.
The boss?
Yes.
Okay.
I enjoy that. Okay. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, he was actually blowing bubble gum, not bubbles like, you know, little kids and such. But what was funny is Diane Sawyer's camera was kind of panning the crowd, mm-hmm. and there he is sitting on top of a tank, and a big, I mean, that, you, super bubble gum is what he had.
God bless him. He can blow bubbles.
Yeah, he looked like he was just chilling, ain't had a care in the world, could you know, care less if Saddam was right there. He was happy, the statue's down. And
that's perfect. In fact, that's the image that we want to project to the rest of the world. We're relaxing, and we don't give a flying F what you think.
I wonder if Iraq TV now thinks that there's a U.S. presence in Baghdad.
I probably don't see it yet.
All right, boss, we'll see.
What did you see?
So I'm just out chilling out, blowing bubbles, just hanging.
Blowing soap bubbles?
I thought it was soap bubbles, yes.
Soap bubbles you normally don't suck back into your mouth.
I was doing two or three things at the same time. What?
Nothing. Sometimes you worry me.
I don't worry you.
He's blowing bubbles. Right in the bubbles, he's putting elephants.
Oh, I saw it.
No. Hello, Andy.
Hey, guys.
Yep.
I got a comment for this jackass. He's running his mouth about the guy blowing bubbles.
Oh.
I'm a Desert Storm vet, and I want to know if this guy ever served and what business it is to run his mouth about somebody trying to relax and just enjoy something that somebody sent him. Just take the edge off.
I don't care what he's doing. If they want, let them drink. He can be sitting there with a Lone Star. I really don't care. If he's done everything and he served his country, you've earned it. You could sit there and blow bubbles until you're done.
Mm, yeah.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Andy. Thanks.
As soon as that statue fell, that apparently some fighting broke out right at Baghdad University.
And about what?
What did the fighting break out over? Fighting as soon as the statue fell, at that same time they were celebrating in the square.
Okay.
Over Baghdad University, fighting broke out.
So he didn't bring enough gun?
No.
What was it fighting for?
I don't know. Just some resistance over there, and they were.
I thought there was no resistance.
There is at the university.
You really need to get a story and hang with it. First of all, you said it was too
pockets.
It was too easy, and then other times they said they met more resistance than they planned.
What the guy said. I'm just quoting one of the commanders from CNN. But two things happened. It was kind of funny at the university. They were catching fire. And one,
with their hands?
No.
Okay.
People were shooting at them.
Got them, and they're catching the bullets.
No.
Make up your mind.
And it was
live. You don't tell a good story.
It was live, and you could hear one of the soldiers go, "That was effing cool." The F word just clear as day.
On CNN?
On CNN.
Why is it everybody gets to float that? I'm the one that gets in trouble if I let it float.
Because they're live.
So, we're live.
No, we have an 8-second delay. You can catch it.
Obviously, it doesn't always work. Everybody knows about
Anyway, and then we were watching a truck, and it appeared to me to be a Chevy. And about the time I went, it's a Chevy, and it had one of those big guns in the back. I mean, the whole back was nothing.
Was this one of ours or one of theirs?
Theirs.
Okay.
It was one of their guns. I went, that's odd. That looks like a Chevy. Just about the time it just exploded. It was a Chevy. It's gone.
That'd have been a Ford.
Yeah.
Crown Vic, to be exact.
Yes.
Hello, Ricardo.
Hey, boss. How's it going?
Thank you. And I enjoy you calling me that.
Well, it's good to call you that. Just wanted to let you know, they interviewed that guy's parents who was blowing the bubble,
mm-hmm.
and he's from Dallas. So,
oh, is he really?
You know that. Yeah.
Did they say his name?
I don't remember the name, but I know it was on one of the other shows on the Newswire.
Uh-huh.
And they had his name, and I don't remember, but they interviewed his parents, so.
Maybe we can hunt him down. Find it. Maybe we can hunt him down then.
Yeah.
All right, thank you, sir.
All right, God bless.
Thank you. Yes, Dan?
One caller called in and said his mom was on Mark Davis's show earlier.
Oh, really?
And the soldier's first name apparently was Jeremy.
Well, then that's enough. Mike Davis, man. I guess all the nice people get the interviews.
Yeah. Probably had a producer that jumped right on that.
Probably so. Well, I missed it, so I didn't know anything about it. Why would you care? Why would you care what they're doing?
Mm-hmm.
Really, whether they're blowing bubbles, playing Chinese checkers
with the real Chinese.
Russian roulette.
Right.
With real ones. killed another one. I suck at this game. I am so pissed at those two countries. It twists my colon every time I think about it. Of course, Russia denies that they're, and they could be right. They may not be housing Saddam. I don't know how he would make it that far, though. CIA, the last report that I read today, they think they got him. I read something that said that they were jubilant over the fact that they had killed Saddam. They were that confident.
Yeah, I had the story about basically we disagree with the Brits on this. We're saying we got him, and the Brits are saying no, he got away.
Where did the report come from that he's being housed someplace in Russia? Did you hear that, Eddie?
It was the Russian embassy.
Yeah, okay, something like that.
I don't remember the report. I heard it on KRLD, but it was that he had made it to the Russian embassy, and they were trying to work something on getting him out of the country.
Oh, I got it. Okay. That makes more sense.
So he must have got the heads up that we were coming to get him the other night and just booked out through a tunnel, I guess.
How'd he get out?
Booked out.
Through a tunnel?
Through a tunnel.
Military lingo?
Yeah. Not when I was embedded.
Saddam, bombs are coming. Let's book.
Yeah, kind of like that.
And hanging around for bombs? What did we do, Saddam? Let's book. Is it Miller?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, go ahead.
Yeah, boss man.
Yes, sir. God, I love that.
Yeah.
You like that?
Yes, sir.
It was Jeremy Cook, chief from Fort Worth.
Cookworth.
Yeah, he's from Fort Worth. His right. Mama said she's sending the bubble gum.
Perfect. Well, then we'll see if we can get him on. Thank you, sir. It's very kind.
You bet.
All right. All right. They're getting closer, Saddam. Let's book.
I could see him saying that.
Yeah. Because I said it by telephone.
Yeah.
Better get out of there. What are you? I booked. Hi, Chris.
Yeah, what's going on? Did you see it when they were pulling
that? I'm sorry. What's going on, what?
Did you see it when they
were... What's going on, what?
When they were pulling Saddam.
What's my name?
Boss man.
Thank you. All right. Did I see what?
When they were pulling the Saddam's head down the street, there were Iraqis that were riding on top of it.
Yeah, I saw part of that.
Yeah, then they got off and started beating it with their shoes.
Yeah, what is a shoe thing? I understand that's supposed to be an ultimate insult, but I don't understand why a shoe.
I don't know.
Don't know either.
All right.
Just their cousin.
Yeah. Thank you. And I hear the... The U.S. government got a little antsy when they took and wrapped the U.S. flag around Saddam's head.
Yeah.
But they took that off, and then they put the Iraqi flag on. And I believe the whole concern was, all right, we're here to liberate. We're not here to conquer. And by taking and putting the U.S. flag around his mug, it looks like we're conquering. I don't know how long it was between the U.S. flag and putting the Iraqi flag. Did you see, Eddie?
Yeah, it was just a couple of seconds.
Really?
Wasn't very long.
He was pulling it down as they were handing him up the new one. I mean.
Oh, okay. Well, then that was done on purpose.
Then out of respect, they pulled the Iraqi flag off before they pulled the statue over.
Oh, did they really?
Yeah.
I missed that whole thing. In fact, I had a guy send me an email as it was happening, and by the time I got downstairs, I'd missed the thing coming down. In fact, they said the Iraqis tried for, what'd you say, about an hour?
Yeah.
For a while, tried to get it down. I thought it was cool that the U.S. came in and went, hey, you need some help with that? We certainly don't mind. And at that point, we're working with the Iraqi people. How cool is that?
It was great. You wonder what the Hollywood types are saying now that you see Iraqis holding a President Bush's picture and kissing it and going...
Oh, yeah, that's right. I saw
Bush.
One of...
We love you, number one.
Right. Our hero of freedom... I forgot. I saw the picture on one of the websites today.
Yeah. One of them was waving an American flag that had Stallone, you know, the Rocky thing on it, too, on the flag.
Is Sylvester Stallone on the flag?
As Rocky. Like victorious fighting Rocky. They had it on the pasted on the American flag as well as they were waving it down the streets.
Okay.
It's just some of the things I saw.
I understand. Who knows what Hollywood's saying now?
Yeah.
I am so sick of that bunch. It's nauseating. Your protests are going to do absolutely no good at this point. None. It's all right to get out and say, hey, you know what? I'm against the war, but I support the troops. and I'll do anything I can to support them. And then once they come back, then maybe we talk about that we don't do this again. That's fine. But sit there and bag on the country when we're in one of the most dangerous times of our existence? Gotta sound like my dad. We don't know what Saddam has. We still don't know what he's got. Nope. We're lucky when they crossed that line going into Baghdad, they didn't really release chemical weapons.
We better hurry up and find something out.
Mm-hmm. So far, I think they said the chemicals that they found weren't really...
Did you hear the story, Eddie?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember how they phrased it because it was like...
Wasn't as dangerous as we thought.
Yeah. Did you hear that they think that they might have shipped a bunch out through Syria?
Some of the what?
Some of the chemical weapons.
Did we release that story?
Yes.
Good cover. Yeah, that's what I would do. Hey.
Hey, it was here.
They shipped them out. The truck tracks.
There we go.
Hi, Matthew.
Hi, Russ.
What?
The bottom of the shoe insult.
Screw it. Yes, sir.
That is because the bottom of the shoe walks in poop. So they are taking, that's one of the worst insults you can do, is show them the bottom of your foot or hit them with the bottom of your shoe.
I like that. All right. Thank you, Matt.
Sure, man.
Yeah, they had little kids doing it and everything else, beating them with a shoe once it fell.
It just really makes you wonder how everybody that's against the war and said we had no business being over there, makes you wonder what their take is now. Especially that fat bastard Michael Moore. What a grunt.
We have to break.
All right. I got a message for all of those punks.
Mm-hmm.
What? You'll have to wait through the break.
Okay.
I may give the message in the middle of the break.
All right.
I may give it one spot in. You tune out, you go someplace else, you may miss it. And it's a good one.
This is a long break.
Of course they all are.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin. We're back to the Russ Martin Show on Live 105.3. The talk that rocks Texas.
Now at 214-787-1053. Did you see the email that said we should have Dr. Natasha on all the time?
Yes.
How about? No.
Did you and her should do a show together?
No. No.
It was fun.
It was fun for one day. No. I'd kill her.
Yeah.
I'd kill her and her unborn monkey.
She kind of got twisted about that.
Yeah. I don't know if she wasn't getting the jokes or she just didn't find them funny after about an hour and a half.
Yeah, they got it. It was the length of time that called her baby a monkey.
She's 37. Mm. At 37, you have no idea what's going to come out of your womb. You don't?
She'll be fine.
You don't know that?
She's very strong, very healthy.
Make any difference? You can't combat time. You can't combat what it does to your eggs. Even funnier if she had a malformed monkey. Not even a good monkey. Yeah, she didn't hang around after the end of the show. All right, show's over. Gone.
See ya.
Wait a minute. You want to sit down and have a... No. Have to go back to Austin. Well, let's visit. No.
I think she was pissed.
Yeah.
Well, she'd be mid-50s when that kid graduates high school?
Man. Yeah. Late 50s. No, you're right, mid. Obviously, if it wasn't a concern, they wouldn't have to do all these tests when you get pregnant in your late 30s.
They do. Watch it very carefully.
Dan's wife, when she got pregnant, they did all kind of tests on her, especially since it was Dan's seed. Because you never know what he's going to have. Look at him.
I know.
By the way, we did find out Dan is in that Six Flags commercial.
That is Dan?
Yeah.
I thought they said the guy had a ponytail.
Who knows? Maybe he tacked one on.
Oh, okay.
But Trey called him, and he said, yeah, he was in a Six Flags commercial. Want to know how we knew? I don't know if he got any money for it.
Probably not.
Well, look at that. His career's on the upswing.
There you are.
Yes, Joe?
Hey, Ross.
Yes, sir?
I think George Bush probably had the right thing going. I think this is probably why he had the death threat from Saddam. You remember back when he was calling Saddam? Which Saddam, according to Iraqis, means shoeshine boy.
Does it really?
Yeah, yeah. And that's why he purposely called him that. He would always make a point to call him Saddam instead of Saddam. And people were saying, well, maybe it's because of his Texas accent. No, it's because he knew exactly what he was doing.
I never heard that.
And also, you know these human shields that went over there?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when they were panning the audience after the statue was pulled down on one of the news stations, there was some Iraqis carrying a sign, and it said, human shield, go home.
Yeah, it said, you U.S. wankers, actually.
Really?
On the bottom of it, yeah.
Good. All right. Thank you, thank
Thanks,
you, Joe.
Boss.
All right. I like that a lot,
yeah.
Thanks, boss. You married chick, keep her ring on. Which married chick? I mean, yes,
yeah,
Casey?
Which married chick?
Hi, I was
calling. Oh, shut up. Do you want to get in my business?
No, I don't.
Do you?
No.
Mr. Electronic
no.
Wizard?
No. Please, continue on, boss. With this phone call.
Have you talked to anybody today?
I've had an email.
Okay. Anything addressed?
Just that we'll talk.
I hit the delay.
I appreciate
it. I hit
that.
It twice. Yeah. I, honest to God, thought 6 seconds would take care of it.
I'll do something. I'll handle it.
I have a suggestion.
What?
I've turned the mics off, and I'll tell you quick.
Okay.
All right. Oh. Then I recommend you have somebody go. Okay. Is it hard? All right. Go ahead, Casey.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
I was calling to find out the married chick that you're involved with, does she wear her wedding ring while you guys are doing it?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much.
Why do you ask?
Well, I'm involved in the same kind of a situation with a married man, and he wears his.
Yeah.
And I just didn't know if it was a guy thing or...
Nah, taking it off would be rude.
Oh, I think so. I agree. It doesn't bother me. I was just curious. Like I said, if it was a guy thing.
No.
Okay, very good. Right. Thank
you. I'm not saying a word.
What?
Taking it off would be rude. Doing it is rude.
Excuse me. Let me ask you something, if I might.
Yes.
Totally ignoring the events of today.
Thank you.
Which is very hard, I might add.
I appreciate when you... restraint.
When you're banging your friend's wife?
Long time ago.
Uh-huh. Did you guys take your wedding rings off? Pow. Did you?
No.
When you were poking her in the hot tub?
No, but I've learned.
You take the rings off?
You continue to
Did
do
you take
it.
The rings off?
No.
Pow.
Okay. Good point, but that was a long time ago.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, I've...
Is there a statute of limitations on
no,
morals?
But you continue to do it.
On violating... See, you were married and she was married.
I made a mistake.
I do it. I'm not married. I'm not committing adultery.
Okay.
As I've said many times, I'm merely a witness.
You are that.
Trey just brought me something from Michael Moore's website. Let's see what this says. Let's see. Dear friends, this is from michaelmoore.com. It appears that the Bush administration will have succeeded in colonizing Iraq sometime in the next few days. What's the date on this? April 7th. All right. This is a blunt. If I was him, I'd take this off my website today after watching how the Iraqis
mm-hmm.
treat our military. They don't have to go out there and welcome these guys.
Hugging them, kissing them, holding their children up to kiss them.
I didn't see that. Are they?
Yeah, they are.
And just the fact that it was, that's got to be one of the coolest moments. I'm sorry, I missed it. That Iraqis and the U.S. military troops pulled that statue down together.
Mm-hmm.
I have goosebumps thinking about that.
It was something to watch.
This is a blunder of such magnitude, and we will pay for it for years to come. It was not worth the life of one single American kid in uniform, let alone the thousands of Iraqis who have died. And my condolences and prayers go out to them. Now, you're not going to be able to salvage this.
Mm-mm.
So, where are all those weapons of mass destruction that were the pretense for this war? Ha! There's so much to say about all of this, but I will save it for later. What I am most concerned with right now is that all of you, the majority of Americans who did not support this war in the first place, do you not look at television? Do you not look at the Gallup polls?
Apparently not.
Do you not talk to people in real life? Not everybody surrounds them with a bunch of suckasses, which is what you got. The majority of Americans who did not support this war in the first place not go silent or be intimidated by what will be touted as some great military victory. Now more than ever, the voices of peace and truth must be heard. I have received a lot of mail from people who are feeling a profound sense of despair and believe that their voices have been drowned out by the drums and bombs of false patriotism. Some are afraid of retaliation at work or... you know what? If you're in the majority, you don't have to worry about retaliation because there's more of you than them.
Yep. Makes sense.
Hello, Daryl.
Hey, what's up?
Nothing.
Who is this?
It's Russ.
Hey, Russ. I mean, it's chill and all that you got everybody referring to you as boss man.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, it'd be a whole lot better
if you call me Massa.
No, man. Have everybody refer to you as my nigga.
You black people may do that if you prefer.
People can do that.
Yes, I don't let white people use that word.
All
that's right. Your word, and you can use it as you choose.
All right, damn, my nigga.
All right. Thank you, my slave.
Stop it.
Jesus. Where was I? Horses drowned out bombs. Some are afraid of retaliation at work or at school or in their neighborhoods because they have been vocal proponents of peace. They've been told over and over that it is not appropriate to protest once the country is at war, and that your only duty now is to support the troops. Yes, that's true. That's right. Why is it you can't figure that out? Can I share with you what it's been like for me since I used my time on the Oscar stage 2 weeks ago to speak against Bush and this war? I hope that in reading what I'm about to tell you, you'll feel a little bit more emboldened. Is that a word? Did I just ask you?
Yeah, you did.
To make your voice heard in whatever way or form that is open to you. I don't even know if I want to read the rest of this. Movies are cheering. I'm editing now.
Okay.
And thus I said the following from the Oscar stage. On behalf of our producers, Kathleen Glynn and Michael Donovan from Canada, I would like to thank the Academy for this award. I've invited the other documentary nominees on stage with me. They are here in solidarity because we like nonfiction. We like nonfiction because we live in fictitious times. We live in a time where fictitious election results give us a fictitious president. We are now fighting a war for fictitious reasons. Whether it's the fiction of duct tape or the fictitious orange alerts, we are against this war. Mr. Bush, shame on you. Mr. Bush, shame on you. And whenever you've got the Pope and the Dick...
He didn't say it again.
That's the same. It's just, it's the same thing. And whenever you've got the Pope and the Dixie Chicks up against you, your time is up. How could you type that? First of all, how could you say it? And then how do you go back and type it later and not see the absurdity to it? That's why I don't even listen to rebroadcast of this show. Because everything I say is retarded.
That's not true.
Yes, it is.
That's not true. You make many good points.
But it's surrounded by absurdities.
That is true.
I'm sorry, what?
When I talk.
Okay. He goes on to explain, I'll read this. Halfway through my remarks, some in the audience started to cheer. That immediately set off a group of people in the balcony who started to boo. Then those supporting my remarks started to shout down the booers. The LA Times reported that the director of the show started screaming at the orchestra, music, music, in order to cut me off. So the band dutifully struck up a tune and my time was up. For more on what I said... More on why I said what I said, you can reread the op-ed I wrote for the LA Times, plus other reactions. I don't give a rat's ass. I look back at my Oscar backlash. Let's see if there's anything of consequence here. In the 2 days following the Oscars, more people pre-ordered the video for Bowling for Columbine on Amazon.com than the video for the Oscar winner for Best Picture, Chicago. Well, first of all, the Oscars, one of the lowest rated in years. Correct. So there were a lot of people that didn't see it. They just saw the stuff that said, hey, this won an award. That could be the reason.
Yep. What did it? What did?
I know.
Let me see how this ends. It's as absurd as the Iraqi information minister and the things that he was saying.
Yeah.
They're just laughable.
How do you explain the Iraqis welcoming the Americans? How do you do that?
Holding up pictures of Bush, kissing them.
How do you explain them giving the thumbs up as the tanks go by? How they embrace the American flag. How do you explain that? You don't live there. You don't know. How dare you make the decision for that country? Mm-hmm. Even though we did.
But we were right.
Part of that's, if you want to really stretch it, part of that's in our Constitution.
How so?
I'm thinking.
Okay.
In the preamble, to secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. Obviously, we consider other countries our posterity.
Yes.
Does that work?
Close.
See?
Nice.
Say. And our posterity do ordain this Constitution for the United States of America.
Yeah, you're not even reading that. That's impressive.
I went to school.
I know.
I don't know the whole thing. I just know the preamble. I don't even know if I remember the whole preamble. Let me see. We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice. Something about domestic tranquility. Provide for the common defense. Promote general welfare. And establish the blessings of liberty to ourselves and posterity to ordain the Constitution of the United States of America.
Very good.
Thank you. That ain't a good stretch.
Actually, it was kind of what Bush said. I mean, he said, we're doing this for our posterity, which would be our children, because they felt that...
I'm talking about the children of Iraq.
They were basing it on our kids and the fact that he is a future threat.
And he's also a threat to Iraq.
Absolutely.
Okay. We consider them our children as well.
Everyone's created equally.
Thank you. In God's eyes.
Absolutely.
Skate!
Very nice. Good work.
Thank you. Here's how he ends it. Unfortunately, Bush and company are not through yet. This invasion of conquest will encourage them to do it again elsewhere. The real purpose of this war was to say to the rest of the world, don't mess with Texas. If you got what we want, we're coming to get it. This is not the time for the majority of us.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it amazing? I bet he's topped it enough to where he believes it's a majority. Majority of us believe in a peaceful America to be quiet. Make your voices heard. Despite what they have pulled off, it is still our country. Yours, Michael Moore. MichaelMoore.com. In case you'd like to go to his website, I'm sure there's an email address where you can communicate with him and tell him what you think. Mm. Yes, William?
Yeah, I got some advice for you on these war protesters.
Yes, sir.
What you're supposed to do is just punch them in the face right in the middle of their argument, and when they get mad and want to take a swing at you, remind them that they don't think...
Right, I've seen the email. Thanks. You've seen it?
Yes.
Same thing. I've seen that 100 times. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Everybody's seen it. It's a funny joke. Ha ha. We laugh. You know what? I hate to break this down to its really simple form, simplest form, but what are they still doing here? Michael Moore, the rest of them.
You can't throw them out.
Now they don't like anything else that's going on. Two words. Get out. Get out.
I agree.
Get out. Get out. You don't like Bush? You don't like the war in Iraq? You don't like our domestic and foreign policies? Get out. You're ashamed that President Bush is from Texas. You know what? That crap works both ways. Why don't you get out? You want to impale his likeness at a concert?
Yes.
Get out. I don't like that one, Eddie. That one's kind of goofy. Let me hear this one. That sounds like Gomer Pyle.
That's a little.
All right, that one's fine. Just let it play. You want to chunk a grenade in his lap in your music video? Great. Get out.
Yeah.
You want to call our president fictitious while you accept an award from Hollywood? From Hollywood? Get out! Get your fat ass out! You want to do a protest song, and then we find out you ain't voted in 12 years? Get out! You don't want to support our troops. You don't want to remember the people that give up their most precious commodity, their own life, for this country. You don't remember them? Get out. Out! Hollywood makes me nauseous.
Most of them.
You want to bitch and moan about this country? That's fine. Bitch and moan, but have a solution to go with it. If you don't, get out! You don't think freedom is worth fighting for? Then obviously our past disgusts you. Why don't you do this? Why don't you give up your rights and your freedoms and get out? Try this. Once you go to another country, bitch and moan about the government. See how long it takes before you sound like Kirk Douglas, because they're going to cut your effing tongue out.
True.
You give that a shot and you let me know. Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm proud of our troops.
Great job.
The job that they're doing, it's a job that I wouldn't do for any amount of money. I wouldn't want to go. Look at everything that they've been through over the past 3 weeks. I don't care how big of a goob he comes off as. I'm proud of the Commander-in-Chief for the Armed Forces. For what the flag stands for, that thing didn't get tattered by accident through a bunch of peace movements. I still swell up at the national anthem. And I'm proud of this country, flaws and all. You know what? I think I'll stay. God bless us all.
Yes.
And may God continue to bless America. Thank you and good night.
Very well said.
We're back to the Russ Martin Show on Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas.
That rocks Texas.
All right, 5:35. At KLLI, Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas, United States of America. I guess. Hi, Justin.
Hey.
Yes, sir.
No, I'm just going to say that last comment that you made, you know, if you don't like it, get out and all.
Mm-hmm.
I would just want to say that regardless of which side of the argument you're on, mm-hmm. that is the worst argument you could use.
Nope. I'm sick of them. I've had it with them. I'm tired of the pissing and moaning that comes out of Hollywood. If you come up and you bitch and you don't have a solution to go with it, I don't want to have anything to do with you.
No,
it's an absolute waste of time. It's complaining and moaning and not having a solution. It's real easy to look at something and tear it down. But if you don't have a solution, you're as stupid as the people you're bitching at.
No, I'm okay. And that's fine. That argument there is fine. But
thank you. Then we're done.
Very nice.
Thank you.
See, Mark Davis would not have ended that conversation like that.
Why?
He wouldn't if he would have gone on, let that guy make his peace.
He don't have a point.
Well, that's the point.
And the longer I let him talk, the more he thinks he's got a point.
Yes. That's why you can't do it. You can't go 15 minutes and not hang up on somebody.
I'll work on it for tomorrow.
Okay.
We'll take 15 minutes out of the show, and I'll do it like one of the AM talk shows.
All right.
Where people can call in.
Like that guy just called in, and he's going to get to talk for every bit 5 minutes while he makes his point.
They can't talk forever.
Okay.
No. I'll do like a normal talk show. You know what? I'm running out of time. I have to move on. I appreciate your thoughts and your kind concern. How about that crap?
That's we'll have to agree to disagree, that type of thing. That's how he ends.
I can't do it. It still makes me dizzy thinking about that.
I'm sorry.
vertigo.
Hi, Alicia.
Hey.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to say thank you, Russ Martin, for voicing something that the true majority of Americans feel, and they should get out. And what amazes me the most of all is that these idiots that are protesting, do they not realize that it's because of war that gives them the right to protest?
No, no. And that's been addressed 100 times, and they don't. And the fact that Michael Moore can drag his fat ass around this country and make money, he's able to do that because of what's happened in the past through through conflicts in this country. But he doesn't like conflicts.
Then you're absolutely right. He needs to get out. You're not happy with our country? Get out. Go someplace where you might be happy, where they are pussyfooting around.
Yes, thank you. Bye. I know. It's very archaic. It's very redneckish. If you don't like it, get out. I'm just sick of the moaning. And they think that they carry so much weight that people are going to listen to them. I couldn't give a flying F what Pearl Jam thinks about this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Dixie Chicks. Or any actor. Singer. Nobody.
Mm-mm. But they think they're so big. And they get a stage. And they get a camera. And it gets reported when they talk.
It's their first chance at speaking somebody else's words. Everything else is normally written out for them. Mm. Hey, I got a chance to say something. I'm going to go do this. Here's my big shot. I don't care what you think. Good afternoon, Tim.
Hey, Russ, is this you?
Yes.
Yes, Russ. I'm one of the guys you used to hang up on all the time because I used to call and say that I hope you died in a car accident and everything, and I called to apologize to you. I've realized that through this entire war, you're one of the few journalists that actually has enough integrity to get up there behind the mic and say what's true, and I think that all the shiny fatheads who speaking on TV, including most of the reporters and journalism, are trying to drudge the worst out of the president, should have their television shows taken away from them, get put behind a microphone, and have you get put on TV.
Why do I smell a hose job?
I'm not telling anything, Russ. I'm saying I used to listen to you out of sheer spite, and I'm listening to you now as a fan, and especially after what you just said. I'll continue to listen to you, but this time as a fan. I'm sorry that I used to call and say that I hope you died. I called that one time you were talking about not giving up your organs, and I said that nobody'd want your organs because you had a bad liver. You remember all the bad things I said.
Was that you?
That was me.
You get your ass up here. You still got an ass whooping coming.
Well, that's fine, Russ, but I just want you to know that I apologize.
I'm kidding.
You're one of the few journalists with enough integrity to say the right thing.
First of all, I don't really think it takes any integrity because I think the majority of Americans are for this war and what we're doing, regardless
exactly.
Regardless of what the reason. So I'm not, you know, if I was going against the grain, then I would, you know, I would respect me for what I'm doing. But I'm going with what I think most people are doing.
Well, why is it that people on TV, the reporters on TV, get up there and try to say something more controversial then and say, oh, well, you know, peace is much better option, and try to berate the president and try to pick apart everything that he does.
I don't think I've seen that from the media. We've seen it from the eggheads out of Hollywood.
Well, not only Hollywood, but these reporters, they like this focus. They love the stories about the children dying. They love to report 10 times in a row that a hospital was bombed.
Hey, you know what? You got to do both sides of that when you're reporting this stuff, so we don't look like we're glamorizing or polishing up the story. You want the good and the bad side of it. That's what makes us look like we're out there doing the right thing, because we're not trying to cover up what we're doing.
I understand. I still feel the right that you've earned your right to have a television show out of all this.
That's very kind of you, and we welcome you now as a fan.
Okay.
All right.
Nice to have you, Russ. We'll talk to you later.
All right. I liked him better when he was an ass.
Yes.
Mm. Also makes me wonder if the troops, since they have the media with them on front lines or wherever.
Sure.
I'm not going to use the word embedded because I hate that. All of a sudden, that's the click word.
That's it. Yeah, everybody's embedded.
I'm embedded with the troop infantry 105. Hang on, here's another point. Oh, if the troops are behaving differently because the media is there, because somebody's watching over them the whole time. I thought about that. I'm reading the Sunday paper, and there was a close-up picture of a Marine with his gun, and all you could basically see was just, you know, his face and part of the gun. It was a really close-up shot.
Mm-hmm.
And you're just thinking, by the media being there, is that going to affect how this Marine operates or reacts to different stuff? Or would he be doing something differently because somebody's not watching?
I don't think so.
I think everybody always acts a little differently when they either they're in the paper or they're on television or just the fact that somebody's there and they're going to report everything that you do.
Yeah, you're going to act a little differently. You're going to pose. You're going to need a couple of photo ops. But when it comes time to fight, I don't think you forget that anybody else is there but you and your gun and your buddies. I mean, when the bad stuff happens.
I understand. That just makes me wonder if anything different happens. I'd like to ask the Sergeant Major Haney, but Trey said he's still out in the desert someplace. Mm. Just curious.
Some idiot called in on, I believe it was Mark Davis' show, and say, how many people live in Iraq? I mean, in Baghdad. Mark said, I don't know, 3 or 4 million. How many people did you see in that square today?
Oh, I heard that.
Yeah.
That was retarded.
Yes.
First of all, not everybody can get to that square. It's like saying, you know, how many people are in Dallas? Well, a little over 1 million. All right? There's a big protest downtown. There's 200 or 300. Does that mean most of Dallas doesn't care? No. It just means not everybody could get down there.
And they're still afraid. They don't know. There are people thinking there's still some Iraqis that think we're there to kill them.
Yeah.
But they don't know. That's what they've been told for so many years.
Or they don't know that something's going to come flying into that square while all the Americans are there.
True.
I'd still be at home hiding balls deep in my camel. I wait for the all clear sign.
Yes.
You ready for news?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
You still have the audio?
Yeah, I think I do. I
have audio of an Iraqi woman that called into a talk radio station. And just give her, somebody that grew up there, give her take on Americans that are turning on their troops. We'll talk about that here in a second.
5:44, Katie Ryan's in the thing.
Live 105.3, thank you, Russ. Their hour of freedom at hand. Jubilant Iraqis celebrated the collapse of Saddam Hussein's murderous regime today, beheading a toppled statue of their longtime ruler in downtown Baghdad and embracing American troops as liberators. He's killed millions of us, said one young Iraqi. Men hugged Americans in full combat gear and women held up their babies so soldiers riding on tanks could kiss them. As they went by, cut number one is actually a young Iraqi woman who grew up there and can firsthand know what it was like. It's about a minute long.
All right. I was born in Iraq, and I left Iraq when I was 17. And I came to a country that accepted me for what I am. Iraq never accepted me because of my religion. I was a secondhand citizen over there because I was Christian. Iraqi people are dead. Bush is not killing Iraqi people, or our troops are not killing Iraqi children. Saddam killed them a long time ago. And thank God for Bush. Finally, there is a man who can speak for Iraqi children. I know a lot of people will die, and that is sad, but Iraqi people are dead. You just don't know how bad it is living under that regime. So for those people, for those Americans that are ignorant about what's going on in Iraq, please understand, Iraqi people are dead. They have no voice. We can't speak our mind. We can't practice our religion. And this is the only country. Thank God for America. You just don't know how you should appreciate this country. You just don't know how lucky you are. And you know, I am a citizen, and I'm proud to be American. And shame on those Americans that they talk like that about our troops. Shame on them. Bush never killed anybody. Saddam been killing all these children. I cannot speak my mind because if I speak my mind, he'll cut my tongue over there. He will rape our children in front of our eyes. You just don't know how bad it is.
Here we go.
How did they address that? How does Hollywood address that?
I don't know. They don't hear that. They
don't want to hear it. You know why? Because it doesn't help with their argument.
True.
We haven't found any weapons of mass destruction. You know what? Right now, I don't care if we find Dick. I couldn't care less. I don't care what our reason was for going over there, whether it was to liberate the Iraqi people, or we're worried about our own safety, or we're there to drop oil prices. I don't care if it's a combination of all of it. It needed to be done. And God knows the rest of this planet's going to stick their head in the sand, and they're not going to worry about what's going on, because they know that we're always going to be here to oversee this earth. Mm-hmm. They know that. That's what we are. Then they turn their back on us because they're afraid of their relationship with another country. You know what? You better be worried about your relationship with us. Because this is going to come a time where we don't care about anybody else.
I bet not. I'll bet you not.
And that's why they continue to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Always the first ones there, the last one to be thanked, and always the first ones to be turned on. Screw them. I'm done.
All righty. Working with the Bush administration, congressional Republicans are maneuvering to make permanent the sweeping anti-terrorism powers granted to federal law enforcement agents after the attacks of September the 11th. The move is likely to touch off strong opposition from many Democrats and even some Republicans in Congress who believe that the Patriot Act, as the legislation that grew out of the attacks is known, has already given the government too much spy power on Americans. Expanding the government's power to use eavesdropping, surveillance, access to financial and computer records, and other tools to track terrorist suspects.
Yeah, we should have more power.
I don't have anything to hide.
I want
to
call it the sneaky bill. Let them go dig whatever they want. Isn't it funny? We get, what is this? April?
Mm-hmm.
You're about 18, 19 months away from September 11th.
Mm-hmm.
Back to normalcy. They don't need this power. It goes too far. Oh, it was okay back in September or whenever they passed this.
When you're afraid to get on an airplane.
Yeah. All you got to, I even went to CNN's website and looked at the World Trade Center's falling again. The two towers.
Right.
Go back and look at that. A little refresher. Just to remind yourself what the hell what happened on that day. It's damn freaky. I don't know if I'll ever really grasp what happened there. Because I never really saw, I don't think I ever saw the World Trade Center in person. It would have to be a building in Dallas or Fort Worth. Someplace in North Texas I was used to seeing every day. And all of a sudden it's gone.
And you know thousands of people were inside that when it happened.
Yeah. Oh, that still doesn't even dawn on me. I just look at the buildings. Because you don't see the people and the blood and the guts and everything else that goes on. That's an abstract thing. It's hard enough for me to comprehend the fact that both of them went down.
Right.
And then you got to remember there were people inside. And there were people jumping out.
Firefighters were rushing in.
Yeah. I'm getting morose. Read something else.
All right. Here we go. How about this?
Hand me that bottle.
Low-carb diet promoter Robert Atkins hospitalized.
Good. What's wrong with him now?
This is actually with severe head injuries after falling on an icy sidewalk.
That's what he did.
72, he slipped and fell outside the Atkins Center for complementary medicine. A colleague rushed him to the hospital where he underwent surgery for severe head trauma.
Mm-hmm. Probably got dizzy and collapsed from lack of carbs.
Cher hit the top 10 this week with her new greatest hits album, Very Best of Cher. And she had her big going away tour. Very last, see you there, never come back, farewell Cher thing last night.
No.
Oh, I know. She's gone. No, she'll be back. But what makes Cher a rare appearance at the top of the charts interesting is that her label, Warner Brothers, just dropped her last winter after her most recent album, Living Proof, didn't do so well. Warner Brothers said it wanted to concentrate on younger acts and not folks that are like 56. And a former hippie chick. There we go. So they moved on. Ladies' man Colin Farrell spent 5 hours in a private room with two strippers and then left them a total tip of $1,800 afterwards. This comes from the Minority Report.
$1,800 for a couple hours?
That was just a tip.
Really?
Total tip of $1,800. The Minority Report star went into the New York club called Scores, chose blonde performers Evelyn and Veronica to be locked away with in an intimate booth. He vanished into the back room with the blondes about 10, came back out about 2:45.
That's a lot of money on table dances.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it? That's a big tip just for table dances.
Yes.
Hmm.
And finally, there's a new book out called from the James Douglas Barron called She Wants a Ring and I Don't Want to Change a Thing. He offers the 10 things men most fear about marriage. Number 10, giving up erotic, break the guest room fold-out couch sex out for regulated, you do this, I do that, now let's sleep sex. Number 9, surrendering quiet, control, space, privacy, watching ESPN all night, poker, beer with the guys, cigar breath, and stinky sneakers. Number 8, the blah life, boredom, routine. Number 7, becoming an active member in the tamed husband fraternity. Number 6, surrendering his post as president and CEO of Fun Firm, and then having to answer to the board of directors in a firm called Compromise. Number 5, replicating his parents' failed marriage. Number four, divorce. It's clean and simple. Number three, the what-if complex, like, what if I find somebody else I love more? Number two, finally giving up the dream of tasting fruits of all nations, flitting from woman to woman. And number one, the life sentence, for better or for worse.
Hurry up. I got an email I want to read came into the studio.
That's news and information. I'm J.D. Ryan on Live 105.3, The Talk That Rocks, Texas.
Says, do you really and honestly believe the falsehoods that you're spouting? Do you ever come out of your own little world and look around? Do you ever read any news and watch any news programs or even listen to the radio?
Mm-hmm. You punk.
You can't possibly if you're spouting out the garbage that you are. You think the majority is with you? My Lord, you're pathetic. Statistically, the silent majority is with the liberation of Iraq. Didn't I say that?
Yeah.
It's a bunch of crap in here. Oh, you can have your opinion. That's your right. I serve my country and by choice. Everyone in the military... hang on. Somebody didn't use spell check. Everyone in the military did, and we... I'm so pissed off I can't even read this. Can you find it?
Is it the one that's, do you believe? Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
You can't possibly, if you're spouting the garbage you are, you already said that. You remind me of the information minister of Iraq, just spouting whatever comes to mind. It only matters what it makes sense to you, I guess.
You big pussy, why don't you just call in instead of sending an email from a Hotmail account?
Oh, for this.
You grunt?
You're so unhappy, get the hell out and move to Iraq.
Hold on.
What?
He sent that to Michael Moore. He just copied you on it.
Oh.
Yeah, well, you better.
Bust it.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin. We're back to the Russ Martin Show.
Russ Martin Show.
On Live 105.3, The Talk That Rocks Texas.
Rocks Texas. Call Russ now at 214-787-1053.
Yeah, how Trey came in during that last break and said he couldn't find the Duckworth guy, the Army guy that was sitting on the tank blowing bubbles.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw him on Channel 4 in the studio.
I see.
His parents.
Yeah. Mark Davis found him. Channel 4 found him.
Yeah.
Okay. How do you spell Cookworth?
I don't know. I don't even care now. And why anybody would care that he's blowing bubbles on worldwide television, we can care less. God bless him. I appreciate the fact that he's there. If that's all it took to get you over there and do that, fine. I'll send you some Altoids while we're at it. Those are curiously strong.
Yes.
Okay, let's do traffic. Hurrah. All right. One more check on traffic with the lovely Gail Lightfoot.
Thanks, boss. This is brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In Carrollton on southbound 35 Simmons at Beltline, a wreck in the left in HOV lanes has traffic backed up past the George Bush Turnpike. Westbound I-30 Tom Landry Highway at Beckley, the two left lanes blocked and traffic's backed up into the Mixmaster, into the Canyon, and it's also got southbound Simmons backed up to around Regal Row. The left lane's blocked on the eastbound side, and believe it or not, it's backed up all the way to Loop 12. Well, I guess you would believe it because lots of folks are sitting there, and plus, you know, you've got the game starting up, the hockey game tonight, so a lot of folks trying to get there, and now they're stuck. Southbound Tollway at Spring Valley, there's a wreck in the left-hand lane. And also, southbound 35 Simmons at Valley View, there was an earlier problem. They've gotten that one squared away. Now, we've got one in Denton on southbound 35 at State School Road. It's in the left lane. And in Fort Worth on westbound Loop 820 at Beach Street, that wreck on both shoulders and traffic's back up to 377. Organ and tissue transplants save lives. Help now during National Donate Life Month by signing a donor card called the Southwest Transplant Alliance at 888-ASK-HRSA or visit organdonor.gov. I'm Gail Lightfoot on Live 105.3, the Talk That Rocks, Texas.
Pickle, you got her.
Yeah.
Good day. Getting a little chilly tonight again. Not as cold as it was. 38 for the overnight low. Sunny, 73 tomorrow. And then by the weekend, back up into the 80s. It's 61 currently at Live 105.3, the Talk That Rocks, Texas.
All right. Let me see. What was I going to mention? I forget now. Doesn't matter. What do we have to play today, Eddie?
How about... Could the answer be C?
Are there any monkey jokes?
Could the answer be monkey?
Perhaps we could get Dr. Natasha on. I don't know where she is. Base to Trey.
Yes.
Do you have a cell for Dr. Natasha?
Yes, I do.
Call and see if you can get her on the phone while we play. Is there a bunch of them?
Just a few.
Okay. While we play, could the answer be C?
10-4.
All right. C or what did I tell you?
Could the answer be C?
Okay. Yeah, I think after about 3 minutes, she was tired of, she was having a monkey.
Monkey baby?
Yeah. Yes. In fact, the new website.
What?
The new website that we registered for her, because she's got all these different websites, and it's hard to keep track, because you got thelovedoctor.com.
Right.
Then you got betterlovelife, I think, .com, and she's got something else. What she needed was one clearinghouse website.
Okay.
And that way, and then have all the links on there.
Makes sense.
Because every time she's on, everybody always misses it, even though we give the web address 50, 60 times. So we registered for her today. I'm having a monkeybaby.com.
No.
Yeah.
She won't use that.
That'll make any difference. We'll set it up for her.
Okay.
Anytime somebody calls up and said, hey, I missed Dr. Natasha's website. It's the one with the special adult toys. I'm having a monkeybaby.com. Well, I want the one that shows you how to give the orgasm 3 or 4 different times. I'm having a monkeybaby.com.
Gotcha.
Everything's on there and ready to go.
Oh.
She sells a load of crap when she comes on this show.
She does.
She can put up with the fact that she's having a monkey baby, because she is. She's
not having a monkey baby.
She's 37. She doesn't need to be having a baby. She's going to have a monkey.
No, women have babies all the way up to, well.
I know, but you run the risk of having a monkey, and her odds of having a monkey are really good. Hello, Shannon.
Hello.
Yes.
I have a question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
Where do you get off? You sit there and bitch at JD about his relationship, and you're so closed off, you can't even maintain.
Closed off from what?
Oh, my gosh. You porn star.
Did you just say F, buddy?
Oh, sorry.
You're going to have to start your whole sentence again.
Well, no, seriously.
Seriously what?
You can't. Come on. I've been listening for a while.
Okay.
And relationship-wise... I mean, you're not the pro. So how can you give advice?
I'm not in a bad... Am I in a bad relationship right now?
No.
Do I have to stick a track?
Let's take your track record.
Stop it.
I stopped. What?
Let's take your track record.
Yeah, your track record.
Hold a second, Shannon.
You want some of this?
No, I don't.
Are you sure?
Yes, boss.
I will fix it.
Or maybe we go set your apartment there at Mission Control.
Thank you very much. If you just let it go, I will fix it.
I didn't say nothing.
I know.
All right, go ahead. What?
What?
Can you hold on? Dr. Natasha's on the phone.
Yeah.
All right. Hello.
Hi there.
How are things?
I'm recovering.
From what?
From the abuse, massive amounts of monkey madness.
You absolutely love us.
Okay, I do.
How many...
there's something wrong with me. You would think as a sex therapist that, you know, I would protect myself from people like you, but I have a dark side, clearly.
How many radio shows do you do probably in a month?
Probably, well, I do about 3 a morning.
Okay.
So about, almost about 80.
Okay.
90.
Are there any shows where you have this much fun?
No, you're right.
Do you feel this close to the people to where we actually care when you come into town?
No, nobody slaps me with their wiener either.
Thank you.
I like to be weenie slapped. I just found out. It was a real rush, especially on my leg.
Possibly next time we'll work up higher. What, Hold on a second. Were you done with your bitching and moaning?
No, I'm not done with my bitching and moaning.
Well, hurry up. I have the Dr. Natasha on the phone.
Well, I think you should probably ask Dr. Natasha for a little advice.
On what?
On,
I'm not having a baby, a monkey maker, or advice on something.
Well, no, I mean, obviously you have such a problem with relationships, you can't even have a baby.
I don't want a baby.
Well, exactly. I mean, if you knew what a good relationship was, maybe you'd change your mind.
No, I've had really good relationships. I had a relationship where I absolutely loved this woman, and I really thought, excuse me.
Where are you from again? Okay.
Grown-ups are talking. Absolutely loved this woman, but because she wanted a baby, I let the relationship go because I couldn't give it to her. I didn't want to. Now what?
Oh, my gosh. And you're going to give advice to JD?
Absolutely. And I'm not going to take advice from a barrel,
from
barrel of monkeys.
I'm sorry.
Mama.
Oh, from Natasha. Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, maybe she's doing the right thing.
And you know what? How many? Excuse me. Why don't ask me some of these questions. Hey, Russ, how many times have you been divorced? Ask me.
Hey, Russ, how many times you've been divorced?
None.
Hey, me too.
Oh, that's twice.
Oh.
You can't say BS. You can say BS, you can't say the whole word.
Okay.
But that's okay. And I'm in the same situation. I'm not going to put up with crap anymore. I put up with it. You know what? I've had my quota of crap. If I got to be by myself for the rest of my life, I can't wait.
Okay, and I can sympathize with you on that because I'm the same way. I'm not going to put up with any BS.
Perfect. Then you know what? We've had an argument, and we've come to a meeting of the minds, and now you and I agree with each other.
But how can you get advice?
Shut up.
Knew it. You couldn't do it.
She was close. She wouldn't just leave it right there.
No.
Okay? Both of you and I finally found a common ground. We're fine. Let's break it off right here while we're both ahead.
Mm-mm. Well, but you...
She's a chick. She's a chick.
Now, we both agree. But...
It's always a but.
There is no but. Either we both agree or we don't. Hello, ooh-ooh.
I think you just lost your the next missus.
No. Certainly no. No. Mm-mm.
I thought you sounded like you could, that would be a good match. Spicy, putting you in your place.
JD's right. The problem I'm going to run into every single time, regardless of the age, and you're a prime example, is they're going to want a kid sooner or later.
Oh, the baby thing.
Yeah, and I'm not going to have one. I'm 42. I don't want one. I don't need one. There's no place in my life for a kid.
Well, no, you know, there are some women who don't want kids. And
no, they're in the extreme minority.
Yeah,
in fact,
you're right.
That adds to the whole combination of finding a chick. You got to find somebody that you're attracted to, somebody you can have a conversation with, somebody you can be yourself around, and then with everything else you got to add, you got to add into the fact that she don't want a kid. That's a rough combination to match. That's why I've pretty much committed to myself that I'm going to be alone.
Well, I'll send you one of those plastic orifices if you'd like.
I don't need one. I have a slit in my couch.
Ew. No wonder you're not married.
I don't need one. I got my love monkey from Rooms to Go.
I at least hope you have it lined with a little Ziploc baggie.
Yes, I do, so I can clean it out.
Yeah. Yes, you can just dispose of the evidence.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, I'd like for you to be on the phone as we play Could the Answer Be C, just so you can listen.
Okay.
All right. This is a game where I think it's self-explanatory, wouldn't you think?
Okay.
All right. Where are you right now?
I'm in my store.
I forgot that you had a store. Where is it?
It's in Austin, Texas. It's called 365 Days, 365 Ways. .com.
See, that's another website.
Yep.
Oh, you didn't know this because...
that's the name of my store.
Okay, well, hang on a second. We set up one main clearinghouse website for you that we put all your links on, so when somebody calls up and says, hey, I missed Dr. Natasha's website, what is it? Because, you know, you got three or four going, right?
Right.
All right, we registered today, I'm having a monkeybaby.com.
And that will just...
They can go to that website.
What picture are you using?
The website's not up yet. We just registered it.
Okay.
So anytime anybody asks, regardless of which website they need, they'll go to I'm having a monkey baby.com, and they can find out all the links.
Okay.
See?
All right.
So now when you do all those other radio stations, you have one clearinghouse website.
Perfect. Okay.
Having a monkeybaby.com.
That's a good idea, Russ.
Thank you. Seriously, why didn't you do that before with something else like Dr. Natasha or whatever?
Well, that one works, too. That one goes to some of the others.
How many websites do you have floating?
Well, no, you know what we do is I have so many because sometimes I'll have bookers. These people will book me shows.
Mm-hmm.
And so to know that, for instance, like yesterday when I did your show, I had tons, hundreds, actually, of members join.
Mm-hmm.
So the girl, actually, Dana, sent you a fax. So that's her booking. So she gets commissions off of all those bookings.
Sent me a fax for what?
So she sent somebody there a fax. Wait, who's your new guy?
Trey.
Wait, what's his name? Trey?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, she sent him a fax, and that's how he called me and booked me for yesterday.
Anybody know what he's talking about? She's talking about.
She has people that book her,
yeah.
And they get a percentage of whatever she sells.
Yeah, so that's why we have all the.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought you were just coming on to hang out.
Well, I mean, that too.
Slut.
But that's how I make my living.
Slut.
I hang out.
Slut. Oh, no, we're paying her money.
Yes.
Whore.
All in a day's work.
I suppose.
All right, here we go. Let's get, let's get our contestant.
It's time to get lucky and play the game that even a mutant mongoloid monkey could win. Let's play. Could the answer be C? And here's your host, Russ Martin.
All right, let's get our contestant on. Jim.
Yes.
Welcome to the show. What do you do for a living?
I make women's jewelry.
All right. Say hello to Dr. Natasha.
Hi, Dr. Natasha.
Hi, Jim.
All right. John, what are we playing for today?
We'll be playing for 12 months bronze-level web hosting from VertBiz.com, the official web host of Live 105.3 and The Russ Martin Show, a Condoms to Go prize pack valued at over $50, 6 disc collector's edition of NYPD Blue, and a cool cap from Dr. Pepper's 7-Up Ballpark featuring the Frisco Rough Riders.
All right. Here we go. Do you know how to play this, Jim?
Yeah.
All right. You have to get all of the questions right to win the fabulous prize. And here we go. Doctors say that the hardest part about having a baby after a woman turns 35 is A, they lack the ambition to do a good job, B, their bodies are not able to withstand the inside pressure, or C, teaching it the proper way to chuck grunt.
C. Oh, my.
Can I say?
Eddie didn't even mark that as the finisher. Oh. I can't wait to read the rest of these.
Oh.
You still there, Natasha?
Yeah.
Fun, isn't it?
Yeah, I'm just...
All right. See, monkeys chunk grunt.
Yeah.
Just in case you didn't know. Next one. To combat the growing number of children born to middle-aged women, daycare centers are now A, hiring older women so children are adapted to slower reactions, B, staying open later because many of the mothers work, C, installing ceiling nets for all the monkey babies.
Could the answer be C?
Yes. Worried about kids being born to women over 30, people are getting ready for A, an influx of unmanageable teens with parents in their 60s, B, a rise in drug use among children whose parents are far removed from their lives, or C, an overabundance of chimp-like bag boys at local grocery stores.
C.
Yes. Dr. Natasha says that she has high hopes for her child's future, even though she will be almost 40 when it's born. It can most certainly be A, or can most certainly A, take over the family septic business, B, run her online stores when she retires, or C, join the Secret Service just like Lancelot Link.
That's a tough one.
Shush.
C.
C is right.
Your test is rigged.
No, it's not. We're not telling him what the answer is. A study found that children born to middle-aged parents are more likely to A, have lower self-esteem, B, make lower grades than other kids, C, be able to hang upside down from almost any tree.
C.
Women over 30 having kids say it's great because A, they are able to afford the kids a better life, B, their marriages are usually more stable, C, everybody loves monkeys.
C.
The hardest part of raising a child born to middle-aged parents is A, the ability to keep up with the child, B, realizing you might not live long enough to see them get married, or C, trying to get all the dookie out of their monkey ass.
B.
Where are my questions?
You don't get any. I just want you to listen.
I hate this game. Stupid.
I like it.
I'm going to hang up.
Are you really?
Well, it's a stupid game. Where are my questions?
You don't have any questions. I just wanted you to listen. You can't say that. You can take it. You just... She hung up.
She really?
Yes. Still there, Jim?
I'm with you.
All right.
Did she hang up?
Yeah, she's pissed.
I guess the Jane Goodall questions are out of the question, huh?
The which questions?
The Jane Goodall.
I don't know.
Dr. Jane Goodall.
Oh, we'll let that go. All right. We're going to leave it. Everybody loves monkeys. Hang a tree. Monkey ass hair. Mm-hmm. It's even funnier to see that in print.
Yeah.
Where do we leave off? The easiest part of raising a child born to middle-aged parents is A, they are raised in a calm household. B, they seem to mature faster. C, bananas are cheap.
C.
Russ Martin said that he might consider dating a middle-aged woman, especially if she recently gave birth, because A, he could finally prove to people that he's open-minded. B, she would bring everything she needs into the relationship. Or C, he really wants a chim-chim to go with his Mach 5.
C.
Children born to middle-aged women seem to get along better with pets because A, they are more loving. B, they understand the needs of a pet better. C, they'll pick the fleas off of them daily.
C. Okay.
Which ones did I didn't use here? Those monkeys, monkey ass here. Dr. Natasha is defending her decision to have a child this close to turning the age of 40 by saying, A, I'll love it no matter the consequences. B, I'm finally mature enough to have a child. C, monkeys make me laugh.
C.
And finally, Dr. Natasha says the only thing that worries her about having a baby this late in life is A, it will be coming of age when she is ready to slow down. B, keeping her figure after the baby comes. C, trying to breastfeed it through the bars of the cage. I'm reading this one again.
Okay.
What'd I do with it? And then we'll be finished.
Okay.
Doctors say the hardest part about having a baby after a woman turns 35 is A, they lack the ambition to do a good job. B, their bodies are not able to withstand the inside pressure. C, teaching it the proper way to chunk growth.
Yeah.
Tell him what he's got.
He got them all, and he has 12 months bronze level hosting from VertBiz.com, the official web host of Live 105.3 and The Russ Martin Show, plus 6 disc collector's edition of NYPD Blue, a condoms to go prize pack valued at over $50, and a cool cap from Dr. Pepper 7 of Ballpark.
We'll be back with a We're back to the Russ Martin Show on Live 105.3, the talk that rocks Texas.
I'm going to do another newscast.
Yep.
You got one?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't we just finish one now?
About an hour ago. Not quite an hour. Yeah. Not really much new on the war front. Been looking.
Oh, I never heard back from Siebert about the war billboard I wanted to put up. Take one of the ones with my name on it.
Right.
And replace it with, either the Give War a Chance or I guess War Worked or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I don't know if Give War a Chance still means anything.
Well, it's not over. They kept saying that. War is not over, even though they're pretty well broken.
Hello? Trey?
Yes?
Please come here.
told him to find out how much it was going to cost to put the board up. Because they said they thought the billboard company would work with us.
Cool.
Talk to the billboard company?
Yes.
How much to put up the board?
To put it up, take it down, do the vinyl, everything would be $12.50.
That ain't free.
But it's cheap.
But it ain't free.
True, but it's cheap.
No, cheap is free. That ain't cheap. I thought you said the guy would work with us.
He is working with us.
That ain't free.
It's his cost. And well, I've even...
Oh, so I'm the one that's going to be out of pocket.
Maybe the station can come up with some money.
They're not going to pay for crap. $12.50, is that TTNL?
That is TTNL. That's to put it up, design, make it, put it up, then when we're done with it, take it down, put the regular billboard back up.
Man.
What?
It's kind of pricey. Just to make a statement.
It's a statement for our troops.
I realize that.
Our cause.
Yes.
What we're doing.
Yes. Well, we do that every day on the radio.
I understand that.
You know how many
but
people.
It's easy to run your mouth and do it and not put any cash up.
True. Good point.
To show that we support our troops. Why we're over there. What we're doing.
Well, let's change them all then. All the billboards.
No, because then we'd have to pay for it. I'm just taking one of mine with my name on it.
Good.
I can't even support, back up, running my mouth every day. Go see if you can jack him down.
Okay.
Do you know how to get a hold of him?
Maybe tough.
What's the turnaround time?
72 hours. 48 to 72, but...
I'll think about it. Did he start higher and come down?
No, he's a fan of the show, and he's like, I can do it at cost.
Do we have a board in a good location?
Yeah. I mean...
I haven't seen any. I haven't seen anybody's boards. Mine or Stern's?
I've seen one of each.
Where?
I'm
on one with a decent location.
There's one eastbound on 30 out of downtown. I know that.
Really?
Before Garland.
There's a
Going towards Garland?
Going towards Garland.
Yeah.
There's a Stern board on right in front of the Fitchy building.
That ain't mine.
There's one of your boards at 35 and something or other.
Oh, that's a good one.
Well, it's...
At the what?
35 and Powell.
The George Bush?
Yeah, just before.
Mm. See if you can get him down some.
Okay.
Throw in some stuff. Give him the hockey tickets for tonight.
I'll see what I can do.
Thank you.
Game started 2 minutes ago.
Well, he don't know that.
Okay.
It don't have a date on it. It just says game one, home, you know, whatever.
Right.
Throw in some free DP. We got plenty of new Dr. Pepper. See if we can trade out the board for Dr. Pepper.
I'll see what I can do.
We'll throw in a French Kiss My Ass shirt. I'm thinking.
Okay.
I spent a lot of money recently.
I know you have. By the way, my taxes are, thanks to your guy Marty, mm-hmm. speaking of money, are down to $3,700 from $6,800, but I still need the $3,700. Can you make spook?
That's the wrong button.
Oh. Write the check for me.
That noise.
You were going to write one for twice that.
I'm about to lose $1,200.
So I just have to pay it off?
How long before you pay me back?
I can pay you back in about 3 months.
I want interest now.
Okay.
$1,200. Yes, John?
Yeah, I just started a billboard foundation right now. $12.50 from 100 people. You'd be done at 7 o'clock.
I'm not going to take people's cash.
Oh, come on.
If I do it, I'll eat it. Thank you, though.
Okay.
I appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Yes, Chris?
Hey, Russ.
Yes, sir.
Boss man.
Yes, sir.
hey, why don't you hold off on the sign? And then when the troops finally come home, just put a big old welcome back out there in black and white, dude.
I like that. I like. The only thing is, I don't know how long this war is going to go, and I don't know how long the billboards are going to be up.
They're going to be over there a while, even cleaning up and just getting things underway. They're not coming home for a while.
Mm. Well, that's still
a good idea. We'll look into it, though.
That'd still get a lot of publicity, though, too.
I couldn't care less about that.
Okay.
All right, but thank you, though.
All right, man.
All right. Does the guy on line one really want a piece of this? Does he really? Okay. I'll practice for tomorrow.
Okay.
Or I'm going to do the 15 minutes of whatever it is that I'm doing.
Regular talk radio where you let people say what they want and you end up with thank you and goodbye.
Yes. I'm going to practice on this guy.
Okay.
David, welcome to the show.
Hello, how are you?
I'm lovely.
Good.
I appreciate the time, the fact that you've taken time out of your day to call in and share it with us.
Trying to use passivity on me?
Okay. No, I appreciate the fact that you listen. You've chosen it. If we were the only radio station and you had no choice, I wouldn't care. But there are 30 of them, and I do care.
Okay, Russ, let me sit up so I can blow the smoke out my butt. Listen, you know, you really complain a lot about money and money and money. As much money as you make, put the billboard up yourself and use it as a tax write-off. The guy's working for you. You know, you come up with an idea and you expect people to pay for it. I understand you're in radio, and yes, you have that some power over that if people are generous enough, but it's hard enough to come across with money, raising money for charities, then expect to have somebody put out of their pocket something that you need to, that you come up with that you want to do. If you want to do it, pay for it, use it as a tax write-off. I mean, maybe use $12.50 less accessories on one of your vehicles.
That's an excellent point. It is.
Well, I think your idea is great, but why have somebody else pay for it? You want to do it? Then do it. That's the American way.
I absolutely understand that, and you have a very valid point.
And plus, you get to use it as a tax write-off.
Absolutely, and it supports our troops. And you're right. I am rich. Why not pay for it?
Hmm? Why not?
Okay. Thank you for calling.
All right, Russ.
God bless you, and God bless America.
God bless America. Bye.
Very nice. I'm so proud of you. That was great.
This! I'm never doing it again!
Jesus. He got his
Blood! Look at my pants!
I know. I saw your head turn bright red.
I just whisked and blood at the same time!
Very nice. Okay.
How do people do that?
They do it all day, every day. Mark Davis does anyway, or most talk show hosts do. I'm proud of you. You might, 15 minutes is all you got to make it tomorrow.
I can't do it.
And pay me the $100.
Will you take half?
You said you could do it.
I can't.
That's the bet.
I was wrong.
That's the bet.
He doesn't know how much I make. $1,200 may be a lot of money.
Mm-mm. I think he probably figures out with a Batmobile and a Mach 5.
They don't know what I pay for the Batmobile and the Mach 5. Those could be $5,000 cars apiece.
Mm.
They don't know. They have no clue. You have no idea what my raise was April 1st.
Well, I do, but okay.
Did you just call me?
No.
All right, thank you. Could you come in here for a moment?
Oh, no. You gonna try tomorrow at least?
I need to vent for a moment.
Nice. Okay, sure.
You're an idiot!
Thank you.
Mexican post.
I couldn't keep that inside.
I know. You're turning colors.
Honest to God, how do you put up with that every day?
You just do. That's just what most talk shows are about, is letting people have their opinions and voice them and then come to an agreement.
But the problem is they think they're right. And if you let them continue, it perpetuates the wrongness that they think is right.
That's true.
You can't do that. It's a disservice to them. It's a disservice to broadcasting. It's a disservice to this country. You cannot continue to let stupidity beget stupidity. These people have to be murdered in their beds!
No. No.
Did you just laugh so hard you farted?
Murdered in their beds?
I can't stand it!
Just pay us all off now.
I'm not.
You have to. You're not going to be able to do it. You said you could do it.
It's my job to go out and eradicate. I am going to liberate us from stupidity. I'm going to wait, and I'm going to drop bunker busters on dollar stores. I'm going to start there. I'll get a lot of them.
Yeah, yeah you will.
Yeah. Yes, Mr. Trinholm.
What time do you want to do this tomorrow?
I haven't decided. It's a floaty thing. It's going to be when I get into that certain mindset. Why do you ask?
Just curious.
Could be any time. I'll just look at the clock and I go, okay, I'm ready. It's like jumping out of an airplane or bungee jumping or rock climbing. Something you don't want to do, but you think you should attempt. And you have to talk yourself into it. That's what it'll be.
Mark Davis does it every day. He gets to the point where somebody's just an idiot and he goes, we'll just have to agree to disagree. Thank you for
calling. I'm not buying that. That's a cop-out. It's when you finally give it up. When you finally say we agree to disagree, that's a chick thing. That's exactly what it is. Well, obviously, I can't convince you of my stupid side, so I'm just going to say so. That way, both people walk away a winner. Mm-hmm. You can't walk away. Both people can't walk away being a winner in a conflict. Someone has to lose, and they have to lose poorly, and they have to suffer, so they realize you can't keep doing that. I want them dead in their beds!
Jesus. That's just one phone call, 60 seconds. 1/15 of what you have to do tomorrow. Just pay us the cash now.
No, I'm going to give it a shot.
Okay.
Do we still do news?
It's a short one.
You have a short newscast?
I do.
Good. Hello, Jimmy.
Hey, yeah, you know, you can still put up an argument. You don't just have to, yeah, okay, whatever. You still got to argue with them a little bit, you know?
Can I argue with them?
Yeah, just no, not absolutely. Not where you're cussing them and telling them you want them dead in their beds and stuff.
No, you can't do that.
Well, that's not fair.
You can't. But you can still put up a little
argument. That's restricting me of my weapons of mass destruction.
Can't raise your voice and you can't hang up on
I
them.
Can't scream at them?
No.
No.
Well, nobody said that.
Yeah, I said you have to handle it like most talk show hosts do, like Mark Davis does. You can do.
Davis says, why don't you just go over there?
What?
Why don't you go over there and just butt and get it over with?
I'm saying that's
why don't you just go butt Mark Davis?
That's all.
Why don't you go get some Mark Davis butt and while you're there. Huh?
I don't want to.
Obviously, Mark Davis says.
But that's all.
Mark Davis says. Mark Davis says. Mark Davis
says. That's how it started. We're talking about you were listening to him and somebody.
I wasn't doing anything. The only reason I listen to him is he makes me laugh. Nobody talks that way.
All right, pick somebody else. It doesn't matter. But you can't hang up on him and you can't scream at him. That's all. Have a conversation. Disagree.
Well, you didn't say this before we bet.
Yes, I did.
No, you didn't.
I said you can't.
I ain't paying. And why? I ain't doing it.
You can't scream and you can't hang
you
up.
You changed the rules after we bet.
What rule did I change?
Eat me.
Okay. If they could have seen that face. Just that. pucker swinging back and forth. Can't think of what to say to me.
You gonna do news or not?
If you'd like me to, I can. I'll make it quick.
Can we do news now? We can't do news now.
Oh.
You screwed it up for everybody.
I didn't do anything.
We'll take it. Do I want to take this before we break? Oh, yeah? All right. Is it Kaylee?
Uh-huh.
Hi.
Hi.
Yes.
I was just wondering if you realized that you were contradicting yourself.
When?
The girl that called earlier and was sitting there talking about you having kids and how you should do it, you two agreed to disagree, and you just got done saying, and she went on her point on and on again.
Oh, but I was being facetious when I did it, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, well, then that makes perfect sense.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Enjoy talking to you.
Mm-hmm, you too.
Not really.
Bye.
See, you can't do that.
Why?
You can't do that. Have a little after comments. Not really. You just can't. You have to finish it with, enjoy talking to you.
It ain't bad enough. I got gray hair and a mortgage.
I'm sorry. Everyone else, just don't do it. Don't even try. Just pay us off.
I'll try it.
Okay. Because Lord knows you're rich and got the cash. Just pay us off.
We'll be back with the Russ Martin Show. We're back to the Russ Martin Show.
Russ Martin Show.
On Live 105.3. The Talk. That rocks Texas.
Rocks Texas.
All right. You never did the news thing at 6:30, did you?
Yeah.
Anything else going on?
Not really. Missing Iraqi President Saddam Hussein could be hiding out in the Russian embassy in Baghdad, they say. All officials from the U.S. appeared cautiously.
Well, where did that one come from? The fact that he may be at the Russian embassy? Because you read one thing that says the CIA is positive that they got him with his advisors.
Right. And then the British press is saying just the opposite. I believe he escaped. Washington Times reported that based on multiple intelligence sources who saw Saddam enter the targeted building, never saw him get out. We're pretty sure he's dead. British intelligence sources told the Guardian newspaper that though Saddam was almost certainly in the targeted building at some point, he was probably not there when the bombs were dropped. And now they say he may be in the Russian embassy, Speaker of the Lebanese Parliament suggested today. So they basically don't know until they do the DNA tests on the bodies they found in the rubble.
Well, they haven't found anything yet, have they?
I don't even know. God, I saw the hole. Did you see the hole they put in the ground?
Mm-mm.
Scary. Frightening.
Well, like how big?
It was probably 30 yards across and just mess.
Hang on.
Nothing else, please, Tom.
Yes, Mr. Trinhan?
I just got a call from Kathleen Harrington.
At TXCN?
Yes.
What does she want?
They would like to come over and film your 15 minutes.
Of what? Oh, no.
Yeah, they said
did
they
she really?
It. Yeah, they want it on film.
Why?
Because they don't think you can do it either. But think it'll be fun to watch.
I don't know when I'm going to do it, so I can't give them a time.
Well, I'm sure they can send a crew over.
I'll let them know. Isn't she funny?
Mm-hmm.
That nutty little Kathleen Harrington. Little producer.
Yes.
TXCN.
Right.
Little Belo Cable Company. Channel 38.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't even get 39.
Mm-mm.
Had to settle for 38. Is that it? Why are you still in here?
Oh, because I've got a list of people that want to be on the show. Guest.
Go right ahead.
Okay. Hugh Jackman and Famke Jensen for X-Men 2.
Can you really get down? Seriously?
Yeah, the publicity people contacted.
Are they called us already? We can have them both?
I don't know if we can have them both, but one or the other.
Wow. Who is that?
I have no clue.
No, I don't want.
Did you not see X-Men?
Mm-mm.
Famke Janssen's really hot. She was the Bond girl in the first Pierce
Brosnan.
What's
her name?
Famke Janssen.
Hold on. Let me pull up a website really quick. Hold on. She ever appeared nude?
No.
No?
It's a modeling nude.
Okay. Well, let me see if I can find it on her. You piece of snot! I start typing in the web address and it flips to another part of the screen. What's her name? Funyun what?
F-A-M-K-E. Famke.
F-A-M-K-E. There it is. Famke Janssen. Let me have a peek. Hollywood Online, Cinema, Famke Janssen Picture Gallery. They want to call in, and they're going to be in the studio.
Call in.
Call-ins with hot chicks do me no good. Let me see this one. Wow. Yeah, underwear model. I believe I can see a little kitty cat there. Oh, I see. Here's a picture of her with Pierce Brosnan. He's got to be gay. What is Famke promoting?
X-Men 2.
Oh, here's another picture. She's a little cutie. How old is she? Is she really? I bet she could have a baby and not have it turn out to be a monkey. Oh, look, she was in Maxim. This will be more revealing. Yes, I would enjoy the Famke Janssen.
Okay.
Sounds like a nice set of speakers.
Yes, it does. Billy Bob Thornton.
He's got a new what?
New movie coming out called Levity.
You know, I liked him in Sling Blade, and after that, you know, I also liked him in, what was it, Armageddon? Yeah, he was good in that. Just grossed me out when he's banging Halle Berry. I'm afraid I would vomit, no. I'm excited about the Famke Janssen.
Okay. Adam Sandler.
No. Seen him before. He's an idiot. What's he pitching?
Anger Management with Jack Nicholson.
That movie must be tanking. It's been out for a while. Has anybody seen it? You haven't, Dan?
Eddie?
No.
Rosalind Sanchez. You've probably never heard of her before.
You're right, I haven't.
Very hot. She's, it's a new, like, Latin movie coming out called Chasing Poppy.
In studio or on the phone?
Phone.
I'll have to look at a picture of her later.
Okay. Sigourney Weaver.
Yes. Phone her in the studio?
Phone her.
What is she pitching?
She's got a new movie coming out called The Holes.
Okay, that'll be fine. She looks like she might be anal, though.
Yeah.
That might turn into another Jamie Lee Curtis thing. Because Jamie Lee Curtis was an absolute C when she was on. I didn't even know that she was going to be on. You guys set it up as a surprise because I'd always been a big fan.
Yep.
And she still was holding up pretty good in True Lies, even though they shot around her flabby ass.
Oh, really?
Oh, when she's doing the dance for Schwarzenegger?
Yeah.
You could tell that was edited around her flabby ass. You go back and watch it. There's never a full bore shot for very long, and everything's very dimly lit, yeah, with blue light.
The lighting was very...
Yeah. I'm going to pass on Sigourney.
Jake Busey.
Is that Gary's kid? Oh, he was in Contact, wasn't he?
Yes.
Was he the guy that blew up himself and part of the thing?
Yeah. Yes.
Yes, I'd like to talk to him.
And then Matt Dillon is starring and directing in a movie called City of Ghosts.
Matt Dillon. No, I got nothing for him.
Okay.
Is that it?
That's it.
It's a lovely list. I can't wait to talk with Fomka Rossgate, Fossgate, Rockford,
Jensen,
whatever.
There's some music acts coming in. You want to talk to any of these folks?
Tell me really quick because we got to go.
Smash Mouth? Yes or no?
They're going to play in the studio?
I can check. They're coming in on Friday. Oh,
they do that rock star song?
Yeah.
Hey Now You're a Rock Star?
That's them.
Yes. If they'll do that song, they can come in.
Okay.
All right.
Charlie Daniels is coming to Billy Bob's.
I like him just because he's pissed off at Hollywood, too.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Taylor Dane.
Yes.
Okay. And finally, Hart, the sisters.
Ooh.
What?
Both of them?
Yeah.
Ooh. In studio?
If you'd like.
Or if David catered.
No. Okay.
Which one got fat? Was it Ann or Nancy?
Ann.
Ann got really fat?
Yes. And has remained that way.
Scared me for a while when I saw her by herself.
Why?
She ate Nancy.
Yeah. I remember seeing her come on stage when I hadn't seen her for a long time, and you could literally hear the audience go...
So it was like when I saw Deborah Harry about 2 or 3 years ago. She was at the... Oh, that's right.
I was with you.
She came out, and I... What?
Yes.
Why is Shecky Green opening up for Deborah Harry?
We kept saying, where's Blondie?
Yeah.
Is she behind the fat chick?
You better move, because we ain't going to be able to hear the Blondie, fat chick. All right. We're done. Yes, right. Those will be... What's the matter with you?
She was, man. She's wearing one of those tight-fitting dresses that wasn't helping her out at all.
But she had some kind of really thick waistband around, like it was going to conceal the fat.
Mm-mm.
Like a utility belt with food in it.
Yeah.
She did that one time. She reached behind her cape and pulled out the thing. It was veal.
I didn't see that.
What?
I must have been getting a beer.
Never mind. Go ahead.
All right, special thanks today for Russ's Road Adventures from Road Avengers.
Hey, did they fix my car?
Yes.
They changed the flat?
Yes.
Did you ask him about the Batmobile?
Yes.
How much?
What's that on there?
Turn the mics off. Oh, that's it. That's all?
He said unless he needed to know exactly where, but he said that.
Oh. I'm having that racing radiator put in the Batmobile. Ooh. So I don't have time to drive it out tomorrow, so he's going to haul it out to the performance shop.
Perfect.
All right.
Go ahead. So it's Road Avengers, roadside assistance and towing. Answer 24 hours a day at 469-853-3723. For more information about the Russ Martin Show, to email us during the show, for details on the Listener Foundation, and the police and firefighter posters and more, go to RussMartin.com. To instant email us during the show, it is studio@RussMartin.com. To visit Trey, it's TreyTrenholm.com. To find Eddie on the World Wide Web, go to EddieBoyd.com. For my site, it's JohnDavidRyan.com. Let's see. Limousine service provided by Ultimate Limos. Call George, 214-668-5363. In the official site for the Talk to Roxas, live1053.com.
Do Natasha's.
Oh, and Dr. Natasha, I don't have it in front of me.
I just said it 4 times earlier.
BetterLoveLife.com. Mm-hmm. Oh, the monkey one. I can't remember it.
I'm having a monkeybaby.com.
For Dr. Natasha, go to I'm having a monkeybaby.com.
Thank you. See you guys tomorrow.
See ya.